Hello, is it me you're looking for? I can see it in your skies.
You would not believe your eyes if 10 million satellites lit up the world as I fell asleep. Yellow is in the sky. I can look twice as high.
Yellow skies up high on WASP 79B.
We all live in a yellow sky planet.
Are we measuring Jupiter clouds? Hubble, Juno, and Gemini.
Ingenuity, my friend, we'll be blowing in the wind of Mars.
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Douglas Barrow.
Baby, baby planet, you got so much gas in you.
Water spout.
Baby planet, do, baby planet, do.
You're fired.
Yeah, please, yeah, I'm rushing out of here. All right, bye guys, leave the meeting.
Yellow is...
What's the time? Well, it's gotta be close to midnight. The full moon of May is near. Did you hear? Just a couple days ago, the moon reached perigee. That's the closest point to Earth. Do you know what that means? It means the moon will appear. Someplace sick with the skies crystal clear to observe. So much beauty to behold. We don't need a telescope. And honey, if you stick with me, you'll see it light up the night. It's the supermoon. It's shimmering bright. The
how many rockets will humans launch before Mars first sees man? Could we travel the surface there without being bounded by the land? The answer, my friends, is blowing in the wind on Mars. The answer is blowing in Mars wind. This helicopter will hitch a ride on Perseverance, which will launch after a month or so goes by. We gave it a name, time to send it on its way. Won't be long until we see it fly. A copter, my friends, will be blowing in the wind on Mars. A copter will be blowing in Mars wind. A copter, my friends, will be blowing in the wind on Mars. A copter will be blowing in Mars wind.
SpaceX Dragon capsule launching humans into space on Falcon 9 and SpaceX capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon
Dragon was waiting at the launch complex.
Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Falcon 9
built in Hawthorne by SpaceX.
Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Falcon 9. Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Falcon 9. Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Dragon capsule Falcon 9. Falcon 9, Falcon 9, Falcon 9, Block 5. Dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule Falcon 9.
Dragon, capsule 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 Falcon 9.
Falcon 9, dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule Falcon 9. Dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule Falcon 9. Dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule Falcon 9. Dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, 9. Dragon, 9. Capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, capsule dragon, launching humans.
Gonna do what it's gonna do.
stars, spirals, twist. Might just be a planet in that disk. Planet forms in debut. Could it be true? Cause baby, it's new. Baby, it's new.
Some of you might be wondering what in the world is going on, and that would be understandable. That's often the question when you come to All Space Considered. Let me be the first to welcome you to the June edition of All Space Considered. Normally would say at Griffith Observatory, but we're not at Griffith Observatory for reasons that everyone understands. So let me go back into the room here. And, you know what? I forgot. So, you know what? The first thing I'm going to say here is that our production values this evening are going to be a little lower than usual. And that is because I am, let me hide non-video participants. There we go. That is because we're doing this purely on Zoom. We usually have the benefit of Matthew in the control room at the LNEH, the Leonard Nimoy Event Horizon Theater. And we've got a bunch of different feeds and a switcher, and it's all very nicely done, beautifully done by Matthew, who does all the work. But this week when we were planning for our show on Friday, LA was in curfew in the first half of the week, and we weren't certain exactly what we would be able to do. So we had to choose a path, and we chose this one to have everyone stay at home, including Matthew, not in the control room. So we're going to do our best this evening with a Zoom program, very much like your own personal Zoom meetings that you have, you know, in your jammies. I think we're all dressed, looks like. But it's going to be a little more informal than usual, and I hope that that will be okay with all of you, because I'm bound to make many mistakes tonight. But we felt we wanted to bring to you a lot of the kind of cool and exciting things that are both have been happening recently and also are about to happen this summer. And so we thought it was an important thing to go ahead with our program, even though we're all working. And I think this applies to pretty much everybody across the country working under very trying circumstances. And, so I think the first thing that we want to say from All Space Considered is we are sending out our best wishes to all of you for a peaceful and safe weekend. And we're very happy that you made time for us on a Friday night to join us. Again, I started by apologizing for, or at least saying, what in the world was with that music? But I am going to apologize for Mars is getting a rover, because I'm telling you, that's going to be last thing and before bed last night. First thing, I mean, I literally woke up to in my head, Mars is getting a rover.
It comes out so easily on a dog walk, doing anything. It's just in the shower.
Swan, we are very grateful, and we're grateful to all of those that contributed videos. We put out a tweet earlier last week, and we encourage anyone who's watching, if you would like to do a little music video for what we used to call walk-in music, is now log-in music. Because we're putting this direct onto YouTube, we don't use any music that might possibly violate any copyright restrictions, which means we have to make our own. But there actually is a purpose behind it. And so we'll come to that in a second, because before I go any further, I want to introduce the people in the room so you know who you're spending this time with. I'm Dr. Laura Danley. I'm the curator of Griffith Observatory and the host for this evening. And with me is Dr. David Reitzel, our astronomical lecturer, and Tony Cook, our astronomical observer, and Patrick So, our theater programs manager. He runs the planetarium and the Samuel Ocean Planetarium and the Leonard Nimoy Event Horizon. So we're very happy to have you be here with you. If you've ever been to All Space Considered, you know that this is the usual crew. So we're continuing our work as we all stay safe and stay home. So with that, there is a reason why we do this music in the beginning. And so Bill, I'd like to ask Bill Grunenberg to come in. Bill was our first musician with that absolutely beautiful rendition of Clair de Lune. And if for those of you who came in a little bit late and might have missed Bill's beautiful piano performance, we're going to play it over the display of pretty pictures during our pretty pictures section. So you will get a chance to hear his performance again. So Bill, what's with all this music? Why are we doing this?
Well, here at All Space Considered, we love science, of course, but we also love music and we love to have fun. So we try to combine these all together, and tonight will be no different. We're going to play a little music game during the course of this presentation. So if you're a regular, we have a lot of regulars, you already know the rules, but tonight they are, of course, adjusted to these circumstances. So you heard or saw the music, heard and saw the music that was played prior to our show tonight. And we call this, as Dr. Danley pointed out, not our walk-in music, but our log-in music. Each piece of music that you heard is connected somehow to at least one story that we're presenting tonight. And if you can guess that connection, you win a prize. Now, how do you make a guess? Well, to make a guess, you include the name of the song or some identifier of the piece you heard and the story that it's connected to. Then you enter your answer either here in the chat section or tweet it at us at Twitter handle, which is at All Space Considered, all one word except no vowels and considered. Up to two prizes will be awarded for each song, one for the first correct chat and one for the first correct tweet. You can pick up your prize at the next All Space Considered we do once the observatory reopens. We have all kinds of things. We have mission stickers. I gotta make sure I have my prop here. Mission stickers, we got pins, we have pens, we have posters, all sorts of alliterative presents, and all sorts of other assorted fun prizes, including calendars. Here's an example of a beautifully produced calendar of Griffith Observatory with incredible photos of the observatory, mostly taken by our dear friend and brilliant museum guide, David Pinsky. Like all calendars, as you can see, this calendar is out of date. I don't know if you can read that. This calendar is from 2019. As you know, because I've said it so many times now, a calendar can be used again. For instance, this 2019 calendar will be useful again in 2030, less than a decade from now. Just stick it in your sock drawer until December 31st, 2029. A 2018 calendar, for instance, would be good again in 2029. A 2017 calendar, its reuse opportunity is right around the corner in 2023. So reduce, reuse, recycle, and please enjoy the show.
Right. Well, thank you for that, Bill. It's a little different when we're not all together, but, you know, because it's kind of fun to shout it out and overshout your neighbors. But alas, that's not our situation tonight. So you can shout at your pet or you can shout at the screen and we're here to hear it. Yeah, David, you want to, while I'm pulling up the screen, you want to show us who's with you?
Yeah, Horton is hanging out on my lap. So if great. You see me try to be like, don't get on my lap. That's fun. Maybe you'll get a visit by Dumbledore later if we're lucky enough. That is.
Oh, that would be a treat. Okay, so I'm going to go back and share the screen to bring us up to And there we go. We don't need Juan again. I'll kill your brain. So, okay. Actually, that's not true. It'll enhance your brain. It'll make your brain happier, but it will stay with you. So, okay. By now, you've got all the introductions. This is We're All Space Considered, and that's how to reach us or follow us if you want to find out what we're up to and what we're going to be doing. And so just to move on ahead, today is Friday, June 5th. Ordinarily, in normal times, we try to do this show on the first Friday of every month. That is tonight. And so here are some of the stories that we're going to be covering. Our top story has got to be SpaceX, right? Because big news, SpaceX goes up and then SpaceX blows up. What's that all about? If you don't know, we're going to tell you. We had a resignation in NASA March and May. I don't know if I should give a clue. Is there a song about it? No, I don't think there is. So it's about the Long March rocket. Anyway, as you can see, we have a number of stories. In particular, we have a guest in the first half. Dr. Ken Carpenter from NASA Goddard Space Flight Center will be joining us. And if you've come to All Space Considered before or other programs at Griffith Observatory, you might know Ken because he comes to visit us often. He works at Goddard and works with what was the WFIRST telescope, what is now the Nancy Roman telescope. And he's going to talk a little bit about that. Then we'll hear about what's going on and our plans to go to Mars. And I gotta say, I love masterful multicolor moon mapping magnificence. And if I am correct, I believe all of these titles were created by the same brilliant minds behind the Dragon capsule, Game of Thrones song. So anyway, then we'll have a little sky report, tell you what's in the sky in the coming month. And then we'll remember John Glenn's widow, Annie Glenn. Then we're going to try, even though we are not all in the same room, to go back to our habit before of pretty pictures and a short break. It's during that time we'll have a nice opportunity to hear Claire de Lune again, as played by our dear Bill, whom you just met. And then in the second half, we have a number of stories that we may or may not get to, because we're going to start the second half with our guests for the second half, Dr. Daniel Kelson and Dr. Louis Abramson, who are going to tell us about a wonderful discovery about the origin of structure and how the universe evolved from its earliest stages to the universe we see today. So we look forward to that. All right, so I think it's time to jump straight to our first story. I think many of you must have seen that we had an historic launch SpaceX partnered with NASA to send astronauts to the International Space Station from American soil. And this was a very big and exciting deal. I think everybody knows by now, so just to not bury the lead, they had a beautiful liftoff, the astronauts are safe, and we're gonna tell you a little bit of the background and show you some of the details that went with that. This is a picture, of course, of the launch. And why is this such a big deal? Why was everybody talking about it? Why was there such a fanfare around it? Well, it's been a while since we launched American astronauts from American soil. You will all remember well the space shuttle program. There it is again. The space shuttle program that launched astronauts on the International Space Station on the space shuttle. And you know that program was retired in 2011. Now it had been around for over 30 years, and the spacecraft and its design was definitely outdated. And as you are also probably aware, there had been two catastrophic missions in which astronauts' lives were lost. So it was clear that we were coming to the end of the shuttle program. And in fact, the shuttle was finally retired and retired happily in 2011. So from that time till this, we have been dependent on the Russian Soyuz capsule or Soyuz rocket to get us to the International Space Station. So that's what you see here is a launch from the Soyuz rocket, and it's a very crowded situation in there. But mainly, we had no way to get astronauts to the International Space Station. So that's been a goal for a long time. So back, actually it dates back to the end of the Bush administration, but certainly during the Obama administration and in 2012, and then again in 2014, advances toward the establishment of a crewed spaceflight capability from American companies to the International Space Station. So the competition came down to two teams competing over the last 5 or 6 years, one team from Boeing and one team from SpaceX. Now I'm saying competing, but it really isn't competing because it's all NASA and everybody wishes each other well and wants to do well. But in the end, the SpaceX team had successes and moved its program along faster than the Boeing team did. And so the glory went to the SpaceX team for launching astronauts before Boeing did. Now it's noteworthy that these are private companies. This is not built by NASA. This is built in a contract with private spacefaring companies, which makes this really quite new and different. Here is an early picture of Elon Musk showing what the crew capsule might look like. You can see some things for scale there on the left. This was in its early conceptual days, and sure enough, they built the capsule and built several capsules and then did a number of tests. And in fact, the so-called crew capsule did successfully launch to the International Space Station last year in March, but it was uncrewed. It just went up and did everything autonomously, but it was successful. And so that was great. Boeing tried the same thing last December and they were not successful. So clearly SpaceX kind of had to jump on it. And then in January of this year, they did a crew abort test, which was a module to be able to get the crew home safely should there be a problem during launch, and that was successful. And so it was all set for what's called the Dragon Demo 2 mission. It's called a demo because we're still showing that we can do it. We're not ready for operations yet until we get through this test. So this is a test mission. And you see the names there, Hurley and Behnken. That refers to these two lovely gentlemen, Bob Behnken on the left and Doug Hurley on the right. Both of them are veteran NASA astronauts. So these are NASA astronauts flying on this mission. In fact, they both have flown on the space shuttle before. And in fact, Doug Hurley was the pilot on the last mission that flew to the International Space Station, the last mission of the shuttle program. So there is great continuity here. And those are the brave fellows who got in this new spacecraft and got on top of that big rocket and got ready to launch to the International Space Station. So there it is, ready to go. And this
10,
is what happened.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition. Liftoff of the Falcon 9 and Crew Dragon. Go NASA. Go SpaceX. Godspeed, Bob and Doug.
America has launched. And so rises a new era of American spaceflight, and with it the ambitions of a new generation continuing the dream. 20 seconds into flight, stage one propulsion is nominal.
So for anybody who was watching that real time, it was very nerve-wracking. These two gentlemen were on board, Bob and Doug, as they called them. You noticed a very different kind of voiceover and very different approach to the way in which this was all discussed. So it was pretty scary to see that happen for the first time and know that human lives were at risk, but it was fantastically successful. So everybody was extremely happy for Bob and Doug. If you are Canadian, you know what I'm talking about. I guess Bob and Doug became astronauts. So it was a very different atmosphere. The CEO of SpaceX said they wanted that very deliberately. They wanted it to show that this is accessible, because eventually a lot of people, they hope that a lot of people will fly on SpaceX. So that was kind of the idea behind this. And of course, there were lots and lots and lots of memes all around the internet. Everyone had the same idea in mind. It was a little weird to hear them keep saying Bob and Doug, or, you know, hearing from Bob and Doug, but that's what they did. And it was quite a lot of fun. So as you can see, there was quite a lot of interest in it. The launch was supposed to happen on Wednesday, a week and a half ago, but then it was scrubbed for bad weather. So originally roughly 900,000 people were watching, but after it was scrubbed and rescheduled for Saturday, you can see that 1.5 million people were watching on NASA TV, another 4 million people were watching the SpaceX feed. So it was very, very widely seen, and I imagine that many of you probably saw it. Everything was great. You'll see they have these kind of nifty touch screens. There are none of those sort of knobs and switches like you see in an Apollo capsule. It's more like an iPhone. They said it's just, you know, it's all a touch screen. And they did, in fact, take it off manual and fly it around, take it off automatic into manual so they can just fly it around a little bit, which was fun. They had the capability of doing that. And then they successfully approached the International Space Station for docking.
So we're closing in at less than 1/10 of a meter per second at this point.
You can see the surface section Draco is just doing all these very small, minor attitude corrections. Really, the autonomous docking system at work, making sure that the vestibule and the soft capture system is lined up with IDA2. It's the International Docking Adapter.
And the second video from the very last
2 meters. We are inside the hands-off point, the CHOP, the crew hands-off point. 1 meter to go. Soft capture complete.
Dragon inspected. Soft capture confirmed. Stand by for retraction and docking.
So that was the second nail biter of the. It was 19 hours after the launch, but that was of course going to be required for them to be safe, and they in fact were safe, are safe, and are now on board the International Space Station. Here they are coming in, and
we have Bob Behnken from SpaceX Demo 2 mission entering the International Space Station.
He looks pretty happy. And Doug hits his head right there. Ouch.
Followed by Doug Hurley.
Yeah, I can't get over that. Even though both of these guys are colonels, we're calling them Bob and Doug. So they joined a crew that was already there, one American and 2 Russians. And now with their addition, there are 5 staffing the International Space Station. So from here, one of the sort of ceremonial things they did was retrieve the flag that was taken up on the first mission to the first shuttle mission. Columbia mission had a flag that flew with it. And when it returned to Earth, it returned the flag. And then the last shuttle mission that went to the International Space Station took the flag up and left it there with the promise that we will be back to retrieve you. So indeed, they came back to retrieve it. And you can see Doug handling it or holding it there. Mission accomplished, in this case, very true. And so, as we mentioned, they're now a crew of 5. They should be able to come back really anytime, but no later. That's what that was there for. If I may just go back there. I guess I don't have the capability. They may go back, they may come down anytime between now and September. There is an outside window after which they don't want to delay any further. Originally the mission was supposed to be maybe 2 weeks for them, but in fact, they're gonna come back. There's work for them to do. As you can see, it's a small crew on the station. And so They hopefully will be coming back certainly no later than September. And then the demo two will be complete. So we're halfway through demo two. We have to bring them home safely to have the final demonstration that this is a safe way to go. But the hope is that, you know, we'll be able to launch regularly to the International Space Station and beyond using this rocket. So when they do come back, they'll splash down in the ocean just the way the Apollo astronauts did, and they'll be retrieved by a SpaceX ship. So we'll wait for that. Could be as late as September, could be earlier, we just don't know. So we'll keep our eyes open on that. So as I mentioned, we've got five now, but the idea is that after they come back, we'll have additional astronauts go up. The Dragon capsule can handle seven people, but we'll take four up, three Americans and one Japanese astronaut. And Tony, I see you showed up. Did you have something you were going to say? You want to say? And you're muted.
I just thought you might want to mention us the name of the mission.
Yes, please. You tell.
Oh, yes. So right after they got into orbit, they announced that the name of the DM2 spacecraft is Endeavour, which was also the last shuttle to dock with the space station. And I believe part of the crew is the same on that mission too. So.
Thank you. That's absolutely right. Sure. So
have you heard from your Russian counterpart?
Dmitry Rogozin is the head of Roscosmos.
You know what? I am going to introduce this one. This is an edited set of moments from a post-launch space conference, press conference that has Jim Bridenstine, whom you will see speaking first. He is the administrator of NASA, the head of NASA, and Elon Musk sitting very safely, socially distancing far apart. And there's a marvelous little exchange in here that some of you may recognize and understand, and some may not, but I'll explain it to you.
Have you heard from your Russian counterpart?
Dmitry Rogozin is the head of Roscosmos in Russia, and I haven't talked to him, but I have seen his public comments. And of course, he was overwhelmingly congratulatory towards NASA and SpaceX. They believe in the partnership, and so I think it's gonna remain strong.
The trampoline is working.
That's right.
Yeah, it's an inside joke.
I know what you're talking.
Inside joke, yeah.
I think that's what you call an awkward moment. But what that was about is that the head of Roscosmos kind of taunted us, was it a year ago, a little longer perhaps, that at the rate we're going, we're going to need a trampoline to get astronauts into space. So you heard Elon say, well, looks like the trampoline's working. And then a lot of awkward moments, which we loved. So we wanted to share that with you. So that was if you saw this slide from a previous show, we had made kind of a little fun of the idea of sending some astronauts up on a trampoline, but in fact, the SpaceX mission worked. So we don't need the trampoline because the trampoline is working just fine. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Let's see, I'm not certain, yes. So Tony, why don't you come on into the room and if you can tell us a little bit about, so we saw the SpaceX go up. Now what's the SpaceX blow up story?
Okay, well, let's back up a little bit. Actually, SpaceX has eyes on much bigger things than just getting NASA astronauts to space station. Elon Musk started the company really with the idea that if you want to go to Mars, you should be able to get there affordably. So his long-term goal and the goal of SpaceX is to create spacecraft that will make traveling to the moon and planets, especially Mars, affordable. So anybody who really wants to do it could actually buy their way there. Anyway, so to do this, he needs a new spacecraft called the Starship. And that's that big thing you see in the middle. It's actually two. On the top is Starship, and on the bottom is a big stage called Super Heavy. And those two would be able to be the basis for getting around the solar system. We see next to them on the right, the Falcon 9, which is the same rocket that was used to launch the Dragon capsule. On the left, the Apollo Saturn V system that Soviet astronauts to the moon. So it's a gigantic spacecraft. We'll go on ahead here. This is a mock-up of a full-size Starship, the upper stage, that could carry 100 people into space. This was unveiled a little over a year ago in Texas. SpaceX actually has three different plants that are building starships. One is in Boca Chica, Texas, in near the south border of Texas. Another one is at the at Cape Canaveral, not far from where they launched the Dragon. And then there's a third in the port of Los Angeles that is going to build components too. That's a new factory. But this is actually what SpaceX is really working on around the clock. And you may have heard in the news that there was some kind of big explosion of something about the time the astronauts launched. And I thought I'd explain what was going on. So if we go on, in Boca Chica, Texas, there's a test program to develop this new capability. Nobody knows how to build a rocket this big, but Elon Musk has some good ideas. They've developed an engine called the Raptor engine, which is the most powerful engine now in the US inventory. And this strange looking device was something called Star Hopper. It's as wide as a starship, but it was only 40 feet high. But nevertheless, over a year ago, it was able to take off, hover, and land, just like they did with tests before they developed the Falcon 9 rocket. So this is real hardware they've flown. But after that, they started building larger versions. So this is as big as a Starship without the crew section on the front. But the idea of this is to test the fueling system and the engine. So this version has one Raptor engine on it. Eventually, Starship will have 32 engines on it. So it'll be an incredibly powerful rocket. But the idea of this is to see if they can light the engine and then maybe hover with this and then go higher and higher until maybe, you know, hopefully in the next year or so actually get into orbit. So very ambitious test. But so far, three of these have destroyed themselves. You know, they blow up when they launch the engine, or during a fueling test, one collapsed. However, people had their hopes up for this. This SN4, as it's called, the fourth Starship test, was a lot more refined than other ones. And here's a picture Elon Musk looking up at a Raptor engine. Even he was pretty excited about this test. But let's see what happened. They fired this four times, but after the fourth test, it started venting fuel and, wait for it. It happened on the day before the astronauts launched. So there was some people thinking, that doesn't look too good. And it totally destroyed the launch pad and the SN4 craft and the Raptor engine and all that stuff. It turns out that they were testing a system for decoupling the fuel they have to fill the tanks. They have to fill these gigantic tanks in just minutes and then get ready to launch. But unfortunately, it started dumping liquid and gaseous methane all over the place, and it caught fire and then blew up. So, does that set them back? Well, let's see the next picture here. That's what's left of SN4 and its launch pad. But behind it, in the next image, we'll see SpaceX is building lots of these huge vertical tanks, and they already have another two rockets almost completely assembled, and they've already replaced the launch pad, and they think by June 10th, they may actually be able to fly SN5. So the next one, which you already see constructed here, is almost ready to go. So the idea of these is just test, find out what goes wrong with it, make improvements, and go on to the next one, because we go to our next picture here, there's a lot riding on this. Elon Musk has already sold a ticket around the moon to a Japanese business person who wants to take a bunch, 20 of his artist friends or something. And he's underwriting a lot of this. So what you see, that big silver one, is a lunar orbiting starship, which could fly, you know, conceivably in 3 years or so, although this has to be perfected. And then docked to it is something that NASA has already contracted SpaceX for, which is a lunar landing version of the Starship. It wouldn't fly back to Earth, but it could ferry astronauts from spacecraft from Earth and then back to the moon with a gigantic reusable spacecraft. So it's very exciting. Whether, you know, even Elon Musk said he might be like 2 years too optimistic for all this to say happen by 2024. But the thing is, it's actually happening. So, you know, round the clock, the stuff is going on now.
So, yeah, Tony, thank you for bringing up the moon mission, because there, that is, of course, another big goal of, am I muted? No, I'm not. Another big goal and mission of NASA right now is to get astronauts back to the moon in the so-called Artemis program. So Artemis is the name of the new Apollo. And by that, I mean that, of course, it was the Apollo program that took astronauts to the moon 50 years ago. There is another program in place, in case you were unaware of it, called Artemis, that has that same goal. Except a little bit different in that they say they want to land the first woman and the next man on the surface of the moon. So I think they've already made it pretty clear that they want to expand this to female astronauts on the moon. That would be nice. So here is a little diagram showing some of the components. I won't go into the details, but some capsule may dock with an orbiting station there that they call the Gateway, which was part of this plan. There's a lot of uncertainty around it. I'll come to that in a minute. And then from there down to the surface so astronauts can land. But as you can see, it's planned for 2024. So any picture like this is going to happen in 4 years. And that is very ambitious. And it's caused a lot of debate and discussion in space policy circles as to whether it's feasible. But as Tony said, things are happening. There are contracts have been let, and there is some metal being bent and that sort of thing. So it is moving along. However, it has had some setbacks, and it had another setback just this past week or past month. And that is, the first setback that I just want to mention is the Space Launch System, which has just continued to have delays. This was the rocket that was supposed to take us back to the moon and do all of these programs. This program has been in place as long as the other that you just saw, the SpaceX and the Boeing programs, but it has had a number of problems. And so now, of course, with SpaceX's successes, and who knows what's going to happen with Starship, but we'll see what happens going forward and what rockets and what modules and how this actually comes together. But the other thing that's been difficult for the program is that they've had a lot of changes in at the top. And it all really started last summer when Bill Gerstenmaier, who is was the NASA administrator in charge, the associate administrator for forgotten the exact title, I have it written up later, they're a human mission director or something like that. Anyway, Bill Gerstenmaier was removed from that role. And by the way, is now at SpaceX. But so he was removed in July of last year. Ken Bowersox, a former shuttle astronaut, was put in place as acting. That really disrupted things last year. And then finally, they did put into place a gentleman named Doug Levero in October, who was in this role. And things started happening. Contracts, as I say, started happening. And everybody's watching it very closely to see whether or not this is something we can actually achieve. So there is his title, Associate Administrator for Human Exploration and Operations Mission Directorate. It's a lot of words, so I didn't remember them all. But anyway, as you can see, he just resigned. And as you can also see from the headline, it was a contract bungle. The issue was that he didn't follow the appropriate guidelines with regard to giving information and balanced treatment to all proposers. And So he was, he was removed and resigned on the night of the 18th, but it wasn't announced until the next day on the 19th. And this is right on the eve, not literally, but just before the launch. Again, this is the Human Exploration Directorate. The SpaceX launch and all of that activity was managed in his part of his portfolio. So it was very dismaying as well to have that happen just before we were about to launch astronauts for the first time on the SpaceX crew capsule. So from what I understand, from what I've read, his intention was to move it along. Because he has certain ideas and preferences or beliefs about what would work, and he was trying to make the process happen quicker, but stepped over the lines of some of the rules. And a lot of that came from the fact that he was under a great lot of pressure. As I've mentioned, this is being watched very closely. And in particular, there was a very notable event that happened last year. No, it was earlier this year. I'm telling you, like everybody else, I don't know what day it is. There was huge pressure put on NASA that it had to happen and happen quickly and happen on the schedule, even though there is widespread concern that the schedule is too much and that it's not possible to put people on the moon on this period of time. So if you've been seeing the news and you've heard these conversations about, well, you know, we're going to put people back on the moon, first woman, next man back on the moon, and it's happening by 2024, this is the environment in which that program is unfolding. So we will continue to watch it, but it is it's a very stressful situation for all of those involved. So with him gone, we now are back with Ken Bowersox's acting again. You can see him with Jim Bridenstine on the left. You just saw Jim Bridenstine, head of NASA, in the Elon Musk press conference, with Elon Musk in the press conference. So that's what's happening on the Artemis program. Now, not everyone is struggling. There are some other space enterprises that are working quite well. And Tony, I think, I believe you're next to tell us a little bit about March in May.
Right. Well, China also has a very active space program. It seems to be very well planned out through about 2030. And, you know, they have various goals they want to make. And one of them now, for instance, is to build a new International Space Station. It will serve countries in Asia, for instance. South Korea will be a partner on it, for instance. Want to also eventually send people to the moon, maybe about by 2030 or so. But to go to these next steps, they actually need a bigger rocket. They developed back in 2016 something called the Long March 5. And now improvements have been made in the engines that make this powerful enough to do a lot of the goals they want to do. So we had to have a test flight. On this test flight, they also tested a new capsule, which also can carry seven people, like the Boeing and the SpaceX spacecraft. Also this rocket is what we call a heavy class rocket. Now, here we see three of them. We see on the right, the Long March 5B, on the left, the Delta IV Heavy, which was the biggest rocket working until after the space shuttle left. Then recently, the Falcon Heavy, the SpaceX Falcon Heavy, which is sort of like three Falcon 9s put together. They've also made improvements, and it is actually the most powerful rocket in existence right now. But anyway, what the point is, it's putting China in the same class as these heavy boosters and will allow them to do the same kind of missions. Here's the new crew capsule. And again, it can carry seven people. It's roughly the size of the Dragon capsule. And here's the launch center in Hainan, an island off from Vietnam. rockets can launch safely from here without dumping boosters on the ground, which is sometimes a problem with Chinese launches. And we'll see a little bit more about that with this mission. Okay, so on May 5th, the rocket was launched. And here's a beautiful image of that rocket going to the sky. And basically, it's arranged a little bit like the Soyuz. There's a big central booster in the middle, and then four smaller boosters, all liquid fuel, on the sides that peel off as the rocket ascends. So it's kind of one big stage and four small stages. So the entire big rocket makes it into orbit. Okay, and we can go on next. After 3 days in space, where they did some testing with 3D printing and testing a number of other things, the capsule made an automated landing in Mongolia. We see airbags inflated. So this one lands on the ground, not on the ocean. And it also has an engine that softens the landing like Soyuz. And here we see a recovery crew looking at the recovered capsule, which I hope is clear didn't carry a crew this time, but this is their first test with it. And it was a total success. The booster is actually bigger than things like Skylab or the Mir space station, which made famous, or actually infamous landings because people were worried about pieces of them running into buildings or something. Fortunately, most of the Earth is ocean, so the chances of being bonked by a big rocket or small, but this is the biggest one that comes down now.
And I can't help noticing, Tony, it goes straight over LA.
That's right. This is one of the early orbits of it. So, you know, basically anything between the northernmost and southernmost part of its orbit could potentially be a target. And no one knew where this was going to come down. About 3 or 4 days after the capsule returned, so did the booster, and we'll see in the next picture, it actually landed just off the west coast of Africa. The yellow dot in the middle is where most of the debris hit in the ocean, but there's a little black dot, a town, it's like New Kotchout, it looks like. Some pieces were found there, too, so some of it did make the ground. So this is something that, you know, China will no doubt take care of. SpaceX, for instance, maneuvers their second stages into a certain crash spot in the Indian Ocean, as do most big boosters. But China has to join that club now. Okay. And with the success of this mission, it's going to open up a lot of interesting things that start this year. There'll be a lunar sample return mission at the end of the year. But before then, in July, China has its own Mars mission with an orbiter, lander, and rover that is due to land on Mars next year, but it will also launch in July during the launch season when several countries are sending Mars missions.
And
same rocket. I'm sorry, this will ride the same rocket.
Got it. Thanks. So, you know, very exciting, very ambitious, off to Mars. But so are we off to Mars. So you may be aware that this summer we're going to have a launch of a mission that had the name Mars 2020, now has the name Perseverance rover. And it is launching July 17th. Mark your calendars. The bad news is that it's launching at 6:15 in the morning local time. So it's one of those things you have to get up early for. We are very excited about it. I will take this moment just to say that the next first Friday of July is actually the 4th of July holiday for us. So we won't be having an all space considered, but we do look forward to bringing programming to you, especially around the Mars mission and the Mars launch. So, you know, follow our social media feeds to see what we're up to, and we'll also post it to our website. And we hope you will come join us to learn more about this Mars mission. But in the meantime, David, why don't you come on into the room? Because I believe you are going to tell us a fair bit more about this mission. Oh, no, you're not.
No, I'm wrong. Yeah, that was a preview. Yay, of what's going on.
Big mistake. Let's go for some big mistakes.
I'll see everybody soon.
Okay, there's the teaser. I'm sorry about that. We are talking about Mars soon, but not yet, because we have another one last NASA story to two brief NASA stories to tell, and a different guest to join us. This is an artist's conception of a telescope called, has been called WFIRST. It's a large telescope that's sort of a follow-on to Hubble in many ways. We'll tell you more about that. But the exciting news about this telescope is that it just got a new name. Used to be WFIRST, as I mentioned, and now it is the Nancy Grace Roman Space Telescope. So this telescope was named after Nancy Roman. And we want to tell you a little bit about who she is and what this telescope does, because it's so exciting. And to do that, we'd like to ask our guest, Ken Carpenter, to come on into the room. While Ken is coming to the room, I'll just share with you a couple brief slides here. You can see this announcement again. Hey, Jim Bridenstine is all over this program tonight from the administrator of NASA, head of NASA, saying that this is the new name, named after Nancy Grace Roman. There is a picture of her. And with that, I am going to stop the share here and welcome. There we go. Have I successfully stopped the share? Who's going to say? And welcome, Ken. So Ken and I have known each other for a little bit of a while, because we both worked on Hubble at the same time back in the
back in the days of Origin.
I know. We were having a day. It's like, do I really want to say how long it's been? He is still at Goddard and working still on Hubble and related to Hubble, and also on the WFIRST, now Roman, Space Telescope. So can you tell us a little bit? First of all, hi, Ken. It's really nice to see you. I'm so glad you could join us. Thank you.
Good to be back. Wish I was out there in person, but this will do.
I know, we could have a trip to Disneyland. Ken is a big Disney fan, and I hadn't been to Disneyland in so long, and we went together, and we got there at 6:45 in the morning, and we left after midnight, we had this intense day of seeing everything there is to see in Disneyland. It was
And we are getting too old for that, but you know.
It was so fun, though. We had so much fun. It was really great. So, Ken, we're so glad you're here, and please tell us, who is Nancy Roman, and tell us a little bit about your telescope. So,
okay, I'm going to attempt to go into full screen mode here.
Okay.
See the slide okay?
Perfect.
Okay, so yeah, who was Dr. Nancy Grace Roman? First of all, she was a PhD scientist. She was the first woman on the astronomy faculty at the University of Chicago. And she has a whole slew of awards to her name. I'll just mention one here, since one of the more exceptional ones. She is a recipient of the NASA Exceptional Scientific Achievement Medal, which is a very rare honor indeed. Parts of the reasons that she was given that medal is that, and remember that this is back in the early 60s, right after NASA was formed in the late 50s. She became the first chief of astronomy and solar physics at NASA, and the first woman to hold an executive position at NASA. This is at a time where there weren't many opportunities and it wasn't very easy for females to get into the field. And she was both brilliant and strong-willed and just worked her way right up to the top very early on in NASA's history. And it wasn't just that she got those titles, but she was a real driving force behind the conception, design, and building of the orbiting astronomical observatories that did some of the first ultraviolet observations of the sky, the International Ultraviolet Explorer, which was a precursor to Hubble, much smaller telescope, only about 18 inches in diameter compared to Hubble's 2.4 meters in diameter, but a real workhorse in astronomy that was designed for a 3 to 5 year lifetime and ended up lasting 18 years and made some of the most astounding discoveries in ultraviolet astronomy.
And if I can just butt in on that one, because, and I promised you I would, because IUE, the International Ultraviolet Explorer, was my telescope. That's what I cut my teeth on. That's what I got my PhD, all the data. And so I was at Goddard, as you know, the control room with literally the PDPs where you had to send a command, you had to flip the switches, like click, 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 and then send to reset stuff. And she was around Goddard at that time. So I did get to see her. And she was a force. She was a real inspiration to all of us, especially all of us young women.
And she went on, she didn't stop there. I mean, she again was the driving force between for just getting IUE built. But then there was Hubble, which took literally decades to get authorized and funded and designed. And she was there the whole time, just pushing behind the scenes and maybe sometimes not so behind the scenes to get it off the ground. She went on to also push for experiments on Gemini, Apollo, and Skylab in parallel with these remote sensing observatories that we've heard so much of. Overall, she was instrumental in establishing a new area of space, new era of space-based astronomical instrumentation and research that, you know, one wonders without her if we would have been 10 years behind in getting that kind of science done in addition and in parallel with the human spaceflight program, which was getting all the press in the early days. She was also, as Laura mentioned, a champion of women in astronomy and a really, really strong STEM advocate pushing for education in science, technology, and engineering fields. You saw this picture earlier. This is a shot of Nancy with a model of the Orbiting Astronomical Observatory back in around 1962 or so. And then in 1972, she was out at Goddard for a while. And you see her here in a control room looking up the numbers. And so that's Nancy. That's why we see the telescope named after her. And I think now we wanted to talk a little bit about the telescope and just very briefly what it will do. As Laura mentioned earlier, it's a Hubble-sized telescope. Its basic difference, well, the two basic differences, one is that it's designed to work primarily in the infrared light that's redder than what the eye sees, whereas Hubble works in the ultraviolet, bluer than the eye sees, and into the optical. So even though WFIRST is following Hubble, it's looking at a different wavelength regime, just like the Webb telescope, and complements Hubble in that way. So we would hope that as we like to see Hubble flying alongside Webb, we'd like to see it flying along the Roman Space Telescope, you know, if we can last that long. The big difference other than the wavelength coverage is that it's designed to be a wide field of view. Instead of zooming in and looking in incredible detail at one object, Roman Space Telescope is designed to take a huge field of view that's 100 times larger than what Hubble can see in a single image. So we can do these immense surveys of the infrared sky. A primary driver for this is to study dark energy and the accelerated expansion of the universe, which is the biggest puzzle in modern astrophysics. We'll also be studying the structure of galaxies and galaxies clusters, and we'll also be searching for exoplanets in a regime that TESS and the Kepler and TESS satellites have not been able to do before. So it's going to be a real workhorse, and it will be a nice complement to both Webb and Hubble. And to really bring home the importance of this wide field of view, I want to show you a short video which shows the Andromeda Galaxy, which Hubble did a survey of about a third of it at full resolution and full color. It wasn't easy for Hubble. It took something on the order of 400 plus images to get that. WFIRST, now the Roman telescope, can do that in two images. So instead of taking a month to get this kind of survey of a nearby galaxy, Roman Space Telescope can literally do it in minutes, which and means
it's at the same resolution of Hubble.
Same resolution. It's just incredible. And that means not only can we do time studies of Andromeda here instead of being able to do it only once, that means we can survey dozens of other galaxies very easily without spending an excessive amount of time. So this is going to generate huge amounts of data. And you know, one question there is, who will analyze all that data? So this is an opportunity for you youngins out there who might be interested in going into astronomy or astrophysics. There's going to be plenty of data for you. So sharpen your pencils or your keyboards or whatever and get ready to go. I did want to take you a little bit behind the scenes here to see Dr. Roman in a little more informal circumstances. Back in 2017, she came out, it was about a year before she passed, came out to Goddard Space Flight Center and did a tour of the Hubble Operations Center to kind of see what her efforts had wrought, and went around to the Goddard. And I was asked as part of this tour to give her a little science briefing on what Hubble had done recently. And I tell you, it's despite the fact I'd been with my PhD for a long time, I felt like I was doing my general exam all over again, trying to talk to her, because she may have been on the elderly end of life, but her mind was as sharp as it was back in the 60s. And you could not just tell her, oh, well, we've got this detector and it's taking these gorgeous pictures. So, oh, wait a minute. Don't just say that detector. Tell me how big are the pixels? How many of them are? What's, you know, and she would just go after you and, you know, to get down to the finest level of detail. So it was a lot of fun, but it was kind of scary. You know, you really didn't want to seem like you didn't know what you were talking about in front of her. Fortunately, that went well. I think she enjoyed it. She also, I think, enjoyed talking to the various people that were around there. And this is just a small sampling of them. Nancy is in the center of this picture here. See here, the center director, Chris Scalise, at the time of her visit. And to Nancy's left is John Mather, who is the only NASA Nobel laureate who got it for his work on the COBE mission and the study of the background radiation. So it was a fun day for all of us. That's more of the operations people. I like this in here because Nancy's just kind of peeking over my shoulder there. This is Pat Krause, the Hubble operations manager. He runs the whole thing for us at Goddard. This is Nancy.
Don't forget Olivia. I just have to shout out to Olivia, who's the woman standing talking. And she, because she was a classmate of mine in grad school and still works for Hubble, and was also, as all of us of that era, were greatly influenced by Nancy Roman.
And you both went to Wisconsin?
Yeah.
That was produced a huge slew of people, especially in the area of ultraviolet astronomy.
Yeah, it was an ultraviolet hub.
Generated year after year, just really, really talented folks like both of you. Here's a picture showing that Nancy was still very active as late as 2017. She's getting set up to do a television interview in the back part of the Hubble Operations Center, which is to her back is where the actual control consoles are. And in the outer hallway, you can see some of the displays of returned equipment from the Hubble servicing missions. And then my favorite photo of this entire collection, this shows some of the women that she helped enable to get careers in the field. To her right, there are two spacecraft engineers. To her left, Olivia again on the science side, Dr. Patty Boyd, who was my deputy operations project scientist on Hubble at the time, and then Aaron Kusilek, who is the head of the Hubble Outreach Program. And this, to people who were around in the 60s and 70s, is an astounding picture to see that many women high up in an organization such as Hubble. And to a large degree, we have Nancy to thank for that. And I think that's it.
Thanks. She used to just be around Goddard all the time. And you know, anytime I went down there, you'd see her. And you'd see her way into her very senior years. She just was everywhere.
She was there. And, you know, when she, I was there once when she looked at Webb in the clean room. And it was the same thing there. You know, you'd give the usual tour that you gave everybody, but no, she wanted it two or three levels deeper than that. It's like, I'm floundering, you know, trying to wave down a Webb person, say, can you come here and talk, you know, detectors or optics or whatever.
Do you know that we have a slide on that? Because we're going to finish up talking a little bit about Webb, and we have that picture. And I did not look closely and realize you might be in it.
Well, I'm probably not in that one. I think she was there more than once, but we'll see.
Okay, we will see. You know, first of all, the Roman telescope is going to be fantastic. Imagine a Hubble, except 100 times, you know, and the fact that the optics are optimized so that you get the resolution of Hubble, but a field this wide is really quite something. And it's had quite a history. It's gone through its funding challenges and political challenges and so forth, but it looks like it's really gonna happen now. Would you agree?
I think so. It was the number one choice of the decadal survey. Every 10 years, NASA goes out to the National Science Foundation, the National Research Council, and says, okay, look at the field overall and figure out where we should put our resources for the coming 10 years. What's the most important thing for us to do? What's the second, third, fourth more important things to do? And try to give us a broad range of missions. Well, the last time we did that such a survey, the Roman Space Telescope came out as the highest priority for a large strategic mission. So that puts a lot of weight behind it. And when we have funding issues from time to time, we point to that and said, you know, this is what your esteemed committee of the best scientists in the world said we should do next.
But you really don't hear about the way you hear about the Webb telescope. And I think also with the name Roman now, it's harder to cancel. Who could cancel Roman? Telescope would be so bad. So last question, because I see Tony's ready to join us too. Come on in, Tony, and hang out for a moment while we make this transition. But launch date, when's it supposed to go?
We are aiming for the mid-2020s. We haven't set an official launch date yet, you know, because we're still fair ways out. We're in basically the design phase of the mission. We are procuring some long lead hardware, buying some detectors and testing them so we can select the best ones. But a lot of the construction of the telescope and its instruments are still, you know, is still to happen. So we'll set the actual launch date closer than that, but we're hoping, you know, 2025, 2026. So a few years after Webb, but hopefully soon enough that Hubble will still be up there and we can get them operating in parallel and cover the entire sky from ultraviolet all the way out to infrared and maximize the information we can get on the objects we're looking at.
Fantastic. Thank you again. Before I go, I'm going to screen share here because I had one more slide actually I have two more slides in my PowerPoint for the Nancy Roman one. And that is the ever important Lego character. That's Nancy Roman. She, together with Lyman Spitzer, were the two that just carried the Hubble forward. So I think, you know that that's, you've reached a certain pinnacle when you get a Lego character. And then I just wanted to, this does not, you have to be clicked over. Just again, reemphasizing the two fields of view comparative field of view. I just keep coming back to at the same resolution. And then here is that image of the video that you showed with all the green blocks coming in. Of how many images did it take?
It's 430 images.
Yeah. So here are 430 Hubble images spliced together with the Hubble field of view, and that gave us that magnificent. And if you haven't, audience, haven't gone to go check it out, because you can zoom in and see every little star. It's insane. It's going to be a fantastic telescope. So,
and just in case, people always ask this question, if you're wondering why the field of view of the Roman Space Telescope looks so odd, it's because to get a very sharp focus over the entire field of view, you have to curve it like that. It's just the way the optics are designed.
Yeah, we dealt with that with a whiff pick. Well, why is it always that little triangle thing or three-piece thing? So, you know, physics and engineering dominates, got to do what's going to be best. So I had a couple more pictures of that, but we're going to move on to that other telescope. For those of you who work on Roman, is this the telescope that shall not be named, or is it a happy collaboration?
Well, we love all our telescopes. You know, we do wish it would get off the ground so we could go full speed, but we have to be patient because none of these huge efforts like this go up quickly. It took a couple of years, decades from conception to actual launch. And we were delayed a couple times ourselves, but they all are designed to complement each other. So we just, having another very capable instrument in the sky is just something we can all get excited about.
Yeah. And where Roman, I have to get used to saying Roman instead of W first, has the Hubble resolution and wide field. This is narrow again, but much higher resolution, much larger mirror. And with that, so one wonders, this huge mirror, how in the heck do you get it to space? And So this is another milestone for the Webb telescope. And Tony, why don't you take it away and tell us what we're looking at and tell us about the latest.
Well, this is the James Webb Space Telescope. It's a 6.5-meter telescope. That's, well, compare that to Hubble, which is 2.4 meters. This is a pretty gigantic instrument. In fact, it's the same size as the telescope we're going to hear in our next presentation in the second half of this All Space Considered, the Magellan Telescope, which is also 6.5 meters. It's you know, one of the biggest, the Magellan is one of the biggest telescopes on the ground. The problem is, how do you get this gigantic telescope that has to be so precisely focused and aimed and shielded from the sun? How do you get it into space? Well, the way you do that is you have to fold it up. So this telescope has a segmented mirror, and this honeycomb of mirror folds up into three sections, and then everything else folds up, and it all fits into the nose cone or the fairing of an Ariane 5 rocket, which is another heavy booster, kind of like the Delta IV. So I think what's next?
There's your 6.5 meter mirror.
That's right. And here at Goddard Space Center. And Laurie, why don't you tell this part of it?
Oh, just, you know, we kind of touched on this with Ken, and indeed Ken is not in this picture. I hadn't looked, but sure enough. So there is Nancy Roman at the clean room. What's behind the glass is a clean room to keep everything pristine and particles and dust and stuff like that, grime off of this very, very expensive and high precision hardware. So anyway, there's Nancy.
I just wanted to mention with this, I heard an interview with Nancy Roman that probably was done about the time that these pictures were taken. And the interviewer from Goddard asked, well, what are you proudest of in your achievements? And she said, well, seeing James Webb and seeing how magnificent that is, and to think I had something to do with, you know, establishing this as a thing, you know, this shows there's a future to this kind of research that she fought so hard for.
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to interject also that the James Webb Telescope is now at Northrop Grumman, and your favorite, I don't know, it's a little, our team went to visit it as well. And but this is not a real picture. It's a completely Photoshopped picture because we weren't allowed to take a picture. So Nancy, they can take her picture, but at Northrop Grumman, there were no pictures allowed. So this was very nicely Photoshopped by our gang, but we all had a great time. And as you can see, are amazed and astonished at the, but you can already see the folding that you were talking about, Tony. So let's come back to that.
Yeah, so for the first time in the many years that this telescope has been constructed, they've actually folded it up the way that it has to be to get into a spacecraft. So, so they're going to do more testing now that they have it folded. They're going to test unfolding it again and seeing how the parts align and stuff. But the goal is hopefully sometime within just a little over a year to maybe a year and a half, there are possible chances to launch this. So, so after it's folded up, it'll be put in a container, put on a ship in the LA port, and taken through the Panama Canal to French Guiana on the east coast of South America, where it will then launch from a ESA French rocket, the Ariane, which at the time this was built was the only rocket that could carry it. So they, and also the European Space Agency, I guess, gets some benefit from providing a launch for this. It's a way of helping pay for it.
So I think what we have next is this little animation that shows.
Okay. So now we'll see how the process of folding it up.
And, well, it looks like it does not play automatically. Here it goes. That's NASA music. Oh, no more music. Anyway, that does illustrate what you were describing there.
You can see how easy it is.
Yeah. So I think that leads us into our final at long last, David. Oh my goodness. Story of what's to come from NASA, and this one's to come next month. And so, David, please tell us.
Yeah, indeed. The Perseverance rover is launching in July, and we have a little bit of an update about that. In fact, we have an update about the other component that's hitchhiking along, sort of, and we can step forward here, take a look at our Perseverance rover in the next slide. And there it is. And it looks a lot like Curiosity. But if you take a closer look at the arm, and we can go forward on it and see the actual arm at JPL, Perseverance. That's the name of the new rover. The first was Curious. This one's going to persevere and learn more about Mars, take some samples. But like I said, there's actually a hitchhiker on board, a helicopter we're sending to Mars. That's right. We're going to fly around on Mars. I'm super excited about it. Let's go forward and take a look here. Here's a drawing, an animation of the helicopter, and we can step forward here. It does have two blades on it, which is needed to keep the bottom part balanced. Those are counter-rotating blades, and a little solar panel up on the top to charge the battery. And here's Vanessa Rupani, who the girl that named the helicopter. In fact, we can step forward here. I think we put up the name, unless I'm mistaken. Yes, there it is. Ingenuity is what allows people to accomplish amazing things and allows us to expand our horizons to the edge of the universe. So that was her quote, and it's a great one. In fact, Ingenuity is the name of this little helicopter, and it is a test mission. This was put on here to test the equipment, to try things out. And let's take a look at it being loaded onto the rover itself. Here are the scientists taking a look at it. You can see the helicopter's in the top part with four black legs attached to it that sort of stand it's on, is not part of the helicopter. We'll move forward, take a closer look at some scientists or the engineers working on the propellers. You can see how large those are. Take another closer look at the propellers here. And going forward again, we can see them preparing how this is loaded onto the rover itself. It's loaded onto the bottom. Believe it or not, the rover is upside down right now. If we step forward, we can see how it's going to deploy. There it is underneath. And if we go forward one, you can see the legs are going to pop out, the second set of legs. Then we'll go forward, get another view, and now forward again, and it actually just falls off the rover. It just drops into place, which is very cool. And now we're going to take a look at some animations or some drawings. These are stills I took from a video. If you want to see the whole video, go to NASA's website. But we can go forward here and take a look. There's our Perseverance rover with Ingenuity that's just dropped off the bottom. And then we can go forward and watch it drive off a little ways and keep going forward, get enough distance between our rover and our helicopter here. And then they will actually launch Ingenuity into the sky. It'll take off, and we can see a little picture of that happening here, a little dust cloud down below. We know Mars is a dusty place, and the helicopter will actually fly up into the air and turn on some sensors and be able to make some measurements, and we can see the drawings of that. So there it is, the little helicopter in the eye, and I love how they tilted Perseverance's viewing mast camera up into the sky to track the helicopter in the air. Well, in the thin Martian atmosphere, remember Mars's atmosphere is only about 1% of Earth's. So those helicopter blades have to spin very fast and they have to be really big. It was tested in a vacuum chamber to be able to see if this would work. And we can go forward here and take a little look, step through them, take another step. And this is simulating some the analysis it'll be able to do as it flies. And again, this is all a test mission to see if this sort of technology will work, but it will do some analysis as it flies and then come back to the ground and land and recharge its batteries and sort of hop along the surface of Mars and test and see if this works as a way to go explore Mars and maybe get close to some things that you couldn't drive up to with a rover. And we move forward again. I think I go ahead and have it land if my memory is right.
Can I ask a quick question? Actually, yeah. The way it looks like, it's going, hey, wait for me to the, but will be required to stay within landing distance? I mean, just sort of buddy along with the rover, or can it go on its own and those two can part ways, or do you know much about the constraints on that?
I don't know the details on it, but I would imagine the little helicopter doesn't have a strong enough transmitter to be able to talk back to Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter that then will beam the information back to Earth or Mars Express, whatever orbiters are up there for him to talk to. So I'm imagining this will hop around the rover until it fails, it crashes. Who knows what they're going to do with it, how well it'll work. Like I said, it's a test, it's an experiment. And then the rover itself has the power to be able to talk to the orbiting spacecraft. But I should look into that. If I'm wrong about that, we'll update you about it, of course. But that's my intuition and what I believe is true. If you know anything out there in the YouTube stream, feel free to type it into the chat and I'll see the correction there in just a second. So the helicopter will fly around. It'll be able to land, recharge its batteries, and then fly again. Like, you know, take off and do some hops. And this is our Mars helicopter. And of course, they've named it Ingenuity. Forward a final slide here, and it will arrive at Mars 2021. So we've got a little time to wait, but really that'll be here before we know it. You know, there's some other things on Mars that have been going on too. The MAVEN spacecraft that's in orbit has a magnetometer on it. It's able to measure the magnetic field of Mars. And well, if you can measure a magnetic field, you actually can use that information to track electric currents. Believe it or not, there are electric currents around Mars. And let's go forward and see if we can get this video to play here. Oh, that's right. We had the paper that came out. It was in Nature Astronomy and the Global Current System of the Martian Induced Magnetosphere. So induced magnetosphere, that's right. Mars doesn't have a planet-wide magnetic field like the Earth does. The Earth has currents down in our liquid core that provide a global magnetic field. That's why you can use a compass, a magnetic compass, to find your way around. It protects us from the solar wind. Well, Mars sort of has this residual field that's buried down into the ground itself, into the Martian soil. So you have little bits that poke out here and there, but no global field. Well, turns out that one gets induced by the solar wind. The solar wind comes flowing past Mars, interacts with the thin Martian atmosphere, actually ionizes some of it, shreds off the electrons right off of it, creates a charge system. If you pull an electron off of an atom, the part that has the proton has an extra positive charge and the electron has a negative charge. And those two will start flowing in the atmosphere and create a flow. And that's the movie we're going to see here in just a second. If we go forward one, we'll see if this movie will play for us and show you what the flows are like. And again, positive charges are going to flow one direction. Negative charges are going to flow the other direction. And what happens is you set up two different systems. You set up one that's near the planet down below and another one that's just outside of there, but the two interact. And when they analyzed this, when they took their magnetic field readings, created the electric currents from those readings, they learned that Mars sort of has this almost conveyor belt that lifts the Martian atmosphere, ionizes it, sends it into this pattern, further out, merges with the solar wind, where it gets blown completely away and will leave. So Mars has a built-in mechanism to strip its atmosphere. And they believe that this was an important mechanism for the stripping of Mars's atmosphere. We think 3-4 billion years ago, Mars was wet. We think there was liquid water. We think the atmosphere was thicker. It was probably warmer due to that greenhouse effect. But this is when the magnetic field, Mars might have had a magnetic field of its own, a planet-wide one. When that died, this sort of current set up and probably help strip the atmosphere. We can step forward one here and see a picture of Mars with that interaction, that sort of gray sheath around it that you're seeing is showing the solar wind blowing it back in that direction. And that's the direction the material would be stripped off of Mars. So this is an interesting story of Mars. MAVEN is helping us learn what happens to a planet when you lose the magnetic field. And it can be bad. You lose your atmosphere, you lose your water, you're no longer habitable. It's not such a great day. So that's the story there. There's some interesting other things going on Mars. The InSight lander has that mold that they're trying to send down into the soil. Well, the scoop is helping push it down, but it's underground again. We didn't have time to add that into the show this time, but maybe in a couple of months, we'll have an InSight update. If that mole stays underground, it could be a neat thing. So, well, that's your Mars update, and I'm happy to bring it to you all this time. I think we're about ready to get to, if I'm remembering right, I think we have some pretty pictures that we're going to show some folks.
We do, and we're still, so we're having a little technical moment over here because that PowerPoint 1 ended there. So let me, and PowerPoint 2. There seems to be a missing section, gang. I'm very sorry. What happened? It's, give me a moment. I'm gonna mute myself and I'm gonna let you guys, figure out.
Exactly. Well, I can keep talking a little bit about Mars, about the 2020 rover, which has been renamed Perseverance, of course. It actually is going to cache material. Unlike Curiosity that went, we did an analysis right there. They had a chemistry set on it. Perseverance is going to go try looking for life itself, the sort of the signature of life. We're going to go looking for that. Well, you need a lab the size of labs we can have here on Earth to really pull that off. You can't just do it on something that's the size of, well, it's like a small car. You know, it has the wheelbase of a Hummer, but the body of it's about the size of a car. So you need a much bigger lab. So they're going to go take samples that they think could be interesting and do what's called caching of them or storing. And then say, all right, Earthlings, you want to really know what happened on Mars. You got to come get these. So we'll need to have a mission created to go retrieve these samples that Perseverance is going to measure and grab. And that, to me, is going to take some real perseverance to pull it off. Who knows what the helicopter will do, but that always worried me. I was never a big fan of doing this caching and doing it. But if it buys us another mission to Mars, if people say, well, now we got to go again, I'm all for it. I just hope it happens soon enough that I get to learn whether those samples had signs of life in them or not, whether there's something in there for us to see.
The news you had on the mole is very exciting. And I was reading something from the team yesterday that they posted about it. And they said now that they actually have it in the ground fully, with continued a little bit of pressure on the top, they're pretty confident that it might actually start burying itself deep now.
But we need to have that as like a cliffhanger. You need to come back in a couple of months.
Exactly. We don't
find out.
They no longer think there was a possibility of a rock or something like that blocking. They just think it's the dynamic of the soil and how that whole mechanism works. But they think it'll work better the deeper it gets itself.
Yeah. Okay. No. That.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say that is the hope, of course, that once it's buried, it'll go down there. But up till now, every time they remove that shovel, it starts to pop back upwards, which is so disappointing. So, yeah. Cross our fingers. Let's hope it works. And we'll learn more about the temperature distribution of the Martian soil. How does it transfer temperatures? That's really what the mole is supposed to go do, is teach us how it changes with depth. So,
yeah. So, as you have a quick question, if I can.
Oh, please.
Pop in.
Yes.
So a quick question from our YouTube audience. They'd like to know where the Roman telescope will be sitting relative to the Earth and the James Webb telescope. So I don't know if anybody knows that offhand, but.
Yeah, the Roman telescope is going to be put at the Lagrange 2 point, as well as Webb. So it's a couple million kilometers far out beyond the moon. And the idea is to get it away from the heat contamination of the Earth and to give you a larger, a continuous view of the sky than you get in low Earth orbit.
So are Webb and Roman going to do like a little do-si-do thing?
Yeah, actually, they don't sit at the L2 point. They do these long, lazy orbits around them, either Lissajou orbits like a figure eight, or sometimes they do very elliptical orbits around the center. It's a very popular place for new missions to go, like I said, to be in a low gravity gradient and to be in a low radiation background as well. One quick thing, if I may add to David's comment on the search for life on Mars, there's a long history on that. The Mars Viking project did a search with an in situ lab on the lander in 1976. And the results are still controversial to this day, thus the desire to bring things back to a bigger lab that can really go at it. And it's not like we didn't try to do it with something smaller once. We did, and we're still fighting about it now. So let's go and do it right.
And bring back samples that we can, not only cache on Mars, but after we bring them back, keep them pristine and be able to use advanced techniques. There's
right, exactly.
So much more we can do here than As you can tell by the less panicked look on my face, I have identified the where we're headed next. So I'm going to share the screen here. And the subject at hand is, if we want to know more about Mars, how can we civilians who can't be an astronaut or fly to the moon or, go to Mars eventually, let's take a look at some of the ways in which we might explore from our desktops at home.
And that's right. I mean, this year is a great year for Mars exploration. And you probably want to know, Mars, where are these places? So this wonderful website called NASA Solar System Treks, there's the website. If you click on Explore Treks, this is what you're going to see. Oh. Well, it doesn't quite work that way, but.
I think we know where they got the name, though, the inspiration. Right. And it is true. You can't really fly around, but you can still explore those worlds remotely.
Okay, so what you can do is if you choose a world, let's say Mars, because we've been talking about Mars a lot, you can go ahead and choose Mars, and I've circled it right there. And once you do that, it will take you to this map. But you can also make this map into a 3D globe. And if we can go to the next slide, you can zoom into the map, you can zoom out. But if you choose 3D globe, which I circled here, you can do something like this. You can just use your mouse and you can move all around it and you can see all the features of Mars. And if you want to look at a specific place on Mars, say like where Curiosity landed, we can go to the next slide. You can choose that from the menu just on the upper left there, Curiosity landing site. So if you click on that, it will give you some information about the site, and then you can fly to the area. And then you can see here that there's a highly detailed black and white overlay map over Gale Crater, which is taken by Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. And you can actually fly down to the closer surface and scroll all the way around and explore this highly detailed map in 3D, and actually even identify some of the features that Curiosity photographed from the surface of Mars. So that's a really great thing to do. Let's go to the next slide here. If you choose the moon, you'll get a beautiful, you can do the same thing. You get flat map, and then you get this beautiful globe of Mars. And I'm gonna leave it as an exercise for our audience on YouTube here. Go to the site and explore the moon. You can do all the same things that we just did with Mars. Not only, we can go to the next slide, not only can we explore Mars, there's a whole list of worlds that are available. You've got Mercury, some of the icy moons of the solar system like Titan, and even two of the large planetary objects, actually Ceres and Vesta. So those are things that you can try out, and you can solar system trek away at those worlds that we've explored. And talking about exploration, in the near future, we'll hope to explore the surface of the moon. And to do that, we need a good, really good map of the moon to find landing sites and areas that we want to identify to land in, especially in the south pole of the moon where there's this water ice. So just a few months ago, the USGS created the first ever comprehensive geologic map of the moon. It's highly detailed and is based on 60 years of mapping of the moon. So it contains pre-Apollo data up to the latest data provided by lunar orbiters. We can go to the next slide. And here's the website, just if you want to go there and see this map. Let's go to the next slide. And these are the orbiters that provided much of the data for the latest map that we're going to show here. And if we go to the next slide, if you download the map and if you download the image of the map, you can see it comprises of the polar regions, north and south, and an equatorial map region. And in the middle, there's a color key for all the geologic features of the moon. It is very, very incredibly detailed. So detailed, we'll show sections of it because it's just too small to show on this screen, the whole map. Go to the next slide, and here's an area of the polar regions and the color keys, and still incredibly small to read those text. Let's take a look at the equatorial region, and you can see the color codes. There's a lot of pinks, and there's some blues there. And we're gonna look at a very small section, and this area, it might be familiar to many of you. It is the Sea of Tranquility, and I'm just gonna get my cursor here. And this crosshair, mark is Apollo 11 landing site, and just about 15 miles away from it is the Surveyor site. 230 miles is the Apollo 16 site, which landed in an area which has different types of geology. So Apollo 11 landed in an area which identified is with this pink color-coded area. And it's labeled LM2. So what is LM2 on our chart? It's an Imbrium Mare, and it's Upper Imbrium Mare. And basically it's a flat surface with not too much reflection and a low crater density, which is a fantastic area for landing your first moon mission. So that's an example of the kind of geology of that area. There's also other geologies here, like the pre-Nectarian, which is very earlier on in the lunar history. Let's go to the next slide here, and here is the near side and far side kind of mapped on a globe. And the next slide. Okay, so how to download it? You can download it right here, and you get the quick fast download, which is a large JPEG, which if you print it out measures 4 feet by 3 feet. So if you have a large format printer, you can have a nice printed map for your house on display. Or you can go for the entire map, which is right here. Can go to the next slide, and I've kind of circled it. This is a PDF, and it's 712 megabytes. So if you're adventurous, go ahead and load that, but make sure you have a high performance computer to show this map in incredible detail. Okay, so we're on to the June Sky Report. And what's happening in our skies this month? Well, last month, I'm just gonna show a few pictures here. Venus was very much dominated the night sky, and especially in the evening. And this is a picture of Venus and Mercury together. We can go to the next slide and see the two. This is a picture I took in that evening when they were only separated by a moon's diameter. There's a little bird that was flying around as well. Makes a pretty picture. Next slide, please. Tony Cook took this picture during the daytime, and just to show how what Venus looked like, even though it looks like a bright dot, it actually presented itself as a very thin crescent. Now, if we were to go out in the evening now, and we can go to the next slide, we'll see the only planet that's visible at this time is the planet Mercury, which was farthest east of the sun yesterday, but still sets about 1 hour after sunset. You can go out and take a look for that as well. It will be in our skies for just a few weeks, and then it will disappear from our evening sky. Now, later on in the evening, if you look around the sky, there are some interesting things you can look for. One is, of course, the Big Dipper. And of course, the Big Dipper is used to find a North Star. But you can also use the last three stars of the handle of the Big Dipper to find Arcturus. And then from Arcturus, you can speed down to Spica. And so that's a useful thing for identifying some of our stars in the late spring sky. Next slide, please. So now in the morning sky on June 8th, if you get up at 4:30 in the morning, look to the southeast for the moon and Jupiter together next to Saturn. And if you wait 5 days and go out in the early morning, the moon will be in a crescent form just underneath Mars. And Mars is now getting a little bit brighter as it gets closer and closer to Earth, and it'll be in opposition to Earth in October when it will be at its brightest. Okay, and well, Venus disappeared from our evening sky, but at the end of the month, it will emerge in the morning twilight, just a few degrees above the eastern horizon. So that's something worth looking for in the morning sky at the end of this month. Okay, and we go to the next slide here. So June is the month where on June 20th, the summer solstice arrives at 2:44 p.m. Our time in here in Los Angeles, where at local noon, the sun reaches its northern most part of its path in the sky. And its highest is seen as from Los Angeles, which is just about 79 degrees above the southern horizon. The summer solstice or the June solstice marks a seasonal change. And that is, we can go to the next slide and we can see that when it's that time when the Earth reaches its point in its orbit where the north pole of the Earth, the north axis of the pole, is tilted about 23.5 degrees towards the sun. And this is a time where summer begins in the northern hemisphere and conversely winter begins in the southern hemisphere. And lastly, a quick rosy look at our moons here. And we have full moon on the 5th, a last quarter on the 12th. And on the summer solstice, there's a new moon and there's a last quarter on the 28th. So those are things for our sky report this month. And so if you have a chance to go out and observe.
I have to say, Patrick, I was not aware that we had a full moon tonight. That's how inside how much time I've been spending inside. So that was something to see. I'll have to go out later and take a look. So with that, we have one last thing before some pretty pictures and a little bit of a musical break. And that is to remember John Glenn's widow. And Angelica, would you share with us that story?
Yes, thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm happy to remember Annie Glenn. So we lost Annie Glenn last month, May 19th. She was 100 years old. She unfortunately did pass from COVID-19. And she's best remembered, of course, for being John Glenn's wife, but she has many accomplishments under her own belt. So if we take a look here. So what she's mainly remembered for her own accomplishments would be that she was an advocate for people with speech disorders.
Angelica, pardon me, am I sharing this or are you?
No, I thought you were sharing them, sorry.
Okay. It's my fault. We'll pick up. Nope, this is another one of these lovely moments. So let me move forward.
Apologize. Okay.
There she is. Okay, my apologies.
It's okay. So to the next slide, we can look at some of her accomplishments and what she's well known for. So she herself, her background was in music. She actually gave up a scholarship to Juilliard to marry John Glenn. They were married during World War II while he was serving, but they had known each other since they were toddlers. They had two children and they were married 73 years. She herself was rocketed to fame with John during the Mercury 7 years, where she was one of the Astronauts Wives Club, and she was she's remembered for being a very supportive member to the other Mercury 7 wives. She also supported John Glenn through 24 years of service in the United States Senate. That includes a run for president in, I believe, 1984. Now, if we look at the next slide, though, we can actually see some of her own accomplishments, which was that for much of her life, up until she was in her 50s, she dealt with dysphemia, which is the sort of clinical term for what we call stuttering or stammering. After she received treatment that gave her much more sort of power of speech, she became an advocate for persons of all disabilities, but especially those with speech disorders. And she received many accolades, one of which, of course, was a doctorate of public service from Ohio State University. The Glenn had a very strong relationship with Ohio State University, and she herself was actually an adjunct professor, served as an adjunct professor and guest lecturer at Ohio State University. So to sort of wrap, John Glenn passed in 2015, just to let you know. I have a video to show you. It's just a clip of an interview that they did shortly before John Glenn's passing. Sort of to just to let you know a little bit about their marriage, which was so long and so remarkable.
Our families both knew each other very, very well. And that's how he and I met.
when you were youngsters.
Two years old.
We never knew a time we did not know each other.
That's it.
And still. Yeah, we had our 73rd wedding anniversary.
Oh, so you were
last April.
Oh, is that right?
We won't tell you how many trips we have taken overseas either, just to be together and the family.
There are very few that can make that claim to have those many years of marriage as well as knowing each other for as long as you have.
Well, and he paid $125 for this engagement ring.
Is that right?
In Zanesville.
This is going back a few years.
And he wants to get me a new one, a good one. I said, this is it.
That's the treasure right there.
Yes, sir.
So that was Annie Glenn. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Angelica. So I mentioned earlier that, in fact, I think I'll just come out of the share for a second, that we would take a little bit of a break. This is the point in which we show pretty pictures. And then after we come back, we will have David Reitzel will be helping us change our scale to the cosmic scale and understand with our guests how all of this came to be and shaped up the way it shaped up. So with that, I'm just going to start. Let's see, I have many technical issues on this little computer of mine. I'm going to start a little bit of music, the Claire de Lune that Bill Grunenberg played earlier, and then we'll just take a little look at some pictures. So as we often do when we're in the studio, I guess I'm going to have to go do it myself. We invite you to turn out your lights and be in a nice darkened environment and enjoy some of the beauty of the night sky. I'm sorry, Tim. I have no idea. That was the file you sent.
Oh, wow, I am really talented.
And I have no idea, but that was the file that you sent. And so my sincere apologies, and also for not muting myself when I laughed. But since we're back, I guess it's just a fine way to come back. I am sincerely sorry. It did make me smile at the end. Like, what were some of those notes? Let me just come back because we are ready to get started for the second part. And this was a lovely image sent by the zoo. Some of you might be members of the zoo, and they are sending out daily reminders that are very lovely to see in these very stressful times. So we hope you liked some of those pretty pictures and that pretty music up until the end when something happened, and I don't know what. This is the craziness of this technological setup here. So we have a quick little, actually, you know what? I'm gonna save. I'm sorry, Jesse and Jeff, but I'm gonna save this until next time because we're running a little behind. And jump on to, in fact, let me go ahead and stop share and invite David. Well, I'll leave it to you, David. I'm gonna go, oh, well, that's very strange. What happened there? Good heavens, I really haven't any idea. Something's happening. I think I know what it is. I think it's what was left over in the old PowerPoint. Started playing, yeah. So that makes sense. So when I go over to the PowerPoint, we're gonna start hearing music again. I will stop that as soon as I can. And then we'll come to your guest segment. All right. Now, finally, at last, let me introduce this by putting up this slide. And David, if you could tell us.
Yeah, absolutely. Happy to introduce our guests tonight and talk a little bit about them. We are lucky to have from Carnegie Observatories, Dr. Dan Kaysen and Dr. Louis Abramson. I've known Dan a long time. Dan was one of the first people that I met when I went to graduate school. I was on a visit there. Both he and I went to graduate school in Santa Cruz at UC Santa Cruz, which is where Lick Observatory is housed. So I feel very lucky to have gotten to go there. It's on a beautiful campus. And I was lucky to meet Dan and his best friend, Scott, right off the bat. It was a great introduction, fun guys. I only recently got to meet Louis, a colleague of Dan's here. But we're privileged to do that because I was sitting around and I saw some press releases, something we do for this show. We gather press releases, and I saw this excellent bit of research all about how the universe got its structure, how this structure showed about. And as I'm reading it, I see Dan Kaysen led this project, and I knew Dan was doing a lot of research on galaxies and at Carnegie. But Dan, this project is a little bit different than a lot of other folks' projects because you attempted to do something that folks might have thought about in the past but didn't quite have access or the ability to do it. And the two of you are going to tell us about it. But thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for inviting us on. I have to say, back in Santa Cruz, we were the ones who were lucky to have you, because once you got there, things, I think, got a lot easier for me. And maybe it was the espresso machine you brought to the office. And so I was able to have a lot of quadruple espressos every day. But whatever the reason was, we were really glad.
Yeah, it was a fun time, something special there we had with all the folks that are there, an amazing crew.
Indeed.
Thank you for joining us tonight to tell us all about the universe and what you've been doing with your time over the past, oh gosh, it sounds like you had a fair amount of time to gather all of this and put it together. Why don't you start? Why don't you take over and start sharing?
I will do that now. I mean, the fortunate thing at Carnegie is we have great people who come in. Like Dr. Abramson was really half of the brains of this project, and I was none of the brains. So, I mean, in a lot of ways, we've been collecting data for years. So let me start this up and get the presentation going. And I should be able to do this. There we go. Let me know if you can start to see things.
We can. And I think, Louis, I think you're still muted. You're probably going to want to unmute. And then I'm going to hide myself. Well, I think if I don't talk, you won't see me.
That might be true. So what I think Dr. Abramson and I are going to want to talk about is something that many of you probably heard a lot about last year, because the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded partly to Jim Peebles, who laid the groundwork for this sort of study as to how matter started clumping together in the early universe and continued clumping over the long history of the universe to give us the structures that we see today. And he laid the foundations of it using what are in effect very complex equations. And what Dr. Abramson and I really worked hard to do is try to simplify these equations into what would be an understandable story. And that's what I want to walk you through. So what do we mean by structure in the universe? I think this is really important, because you look around and you see your house, or you see your apartment, you see cars, you yourself are a structure left over from the dust from exploding stars. But what I want to talk about is galaxies that we live in and where our galaxy lives. So I want to talk about structure on large scales. Often we just call that large scale structure. So we live in a galaxy. Here's a lovely picture from South America in Chile, one of our mountaintops, with our Magellan telescope in the foreground. And you can see towards the core of our Milky Way galaxy in the background. And on the left side, you'll see some fuzzies that are the Magellanic clouds, small neighboring galaxies that are part of our local group. So we have many galaxies that are actually sort of in a region together. We're bound gravitationally, and this is structure on a particular scale. But our local group isn't sitting in an empty region of space. It's embedded in a larger group, a supercluster called Laniakea. And that itself is also embedded in even larger structures. And in fact, when we look on all scales, let's see if this animation will go through. Might get a little fuzzy, but what you'll start to see is this cosmic web where there are regions where there are more galaxies and there are other regions which are void or devoid of galaxies. And you just see this sort of webby structure. It continues on all scales throughout the universe as we look farther and farther back. So the problem that has been looked at for now a few decades is that we know in a hot Big Bang universe, the universe started out after inflation looking quite uniform. In fact, if you were to take a picture of what the densities looked like, if you made a map of the sky at right after a few hundred thousand years after the Big Bang, where the basically atoms came together in a hot soup, it would look like this blue map. In fact, in this map I'm showing on this picture, there are the true density fluctuations of the early universe at that time. It's just that they're so small, at about a part in 100,000, you can't really tell from the small changes in the blue color. So our fundamental question really is how do you go from this to chunks of the universe that look like that? And the scales are actually roughly comparable here. So a lot of matter has to start clumping together. Those small regions that are slightly more dense than their neighbors start to pull in more matter. And here I'm going to show on the left, you'll see very slowly evolving a computer simulation using the basic equations that were given to us by Jim Peebles several decades ago. Slowly evolving over time, you'll see the density peaks pulling in more matter. But all the blobs of matter you see in here, they're not doing the same thing. They're moving around. In fact, there are some places where you'll see them moving across. Some get swallowed up. They're moving around each other. All of the interactions are just due to gravity. And we call these interactions nonlinear, because you can't really solve the equations. They can only be approximated very accurately, mind you, but approximated on supercomputers. The problem when we look at this is, while it does a great job of mimicking what we see in the universe, it's hard to get intuition about what galaxies on average are just doing. How do we build a story out of what's happening here? And so I don't want to spend a lot of time looking at math, but I want to just point out that it starts out complex, and then we decided we could play some tricks, maybe cheat, try to pull out a story. And by doing some very interesting mathematical tricks, we were able to simplify them accurately and pull out a story. Because these equations, they're not solvable by human beings. You can't do them on paper. In order to solve the top one, you need to know the answer to the bottom ones and the middle ones, but you can't solve those without the solutions to the first ones. So it's just a big jumbled mess. So are these equations we have to ask ourselves? I think this is where Dr. Abramson's insights were really coming in, because he was reminding me time and again, these equations describe every movement of every piece of matter in the universe. But as astronomers, we observe the sky, and we're not interested in the movement of every piece of matter. Because what do? We go and we look and we see light from galaxies. We can count up galaxies. We can measure them. We can see how far away they are. And these equations don't exactly tell us about the things we observe, about the things we really see in the sky. So they're great for doing computer models, as I showed you that movie just a moment ago. But again, those equations are not great for helping us understand, tell a story, find a way to explain what real galaxies in the real sky and the real universe have been doing. So what do we do? Well, we recognize, here's again, Dr. Abramson's gonna speak a little bit more about this undoubtedly when I give him a chance, but I'm an old windbag right now.
Keep going.
There you go. We observe ensembles of objects. And I want to talk about what that means, because it means that as astronomers, in some ways, we are doing more sociology than physics at times. Okay. Yeah. So what does that mean for us? We look at galaxies that are near us. We look at galaxies that are very far away. The ones that are very far away, the light took a lot longer to get to us. So the galaxies are being observed when the universe was younger. Those are different galaxies. Some folks in astronomy, many folks in my field, in fact, it's very disheartening, but many folks like to compare the distant ones as individual galaxies, compare them to the ones that are nearby, and think about how those distant ones evolved, how those earlier ones evolved into explicitly the ones that we see near us. But I'm gonna swear up here on the slide, if you can believe, the problem with that approach is that every volume you observe, every set of galaxies you observe farther and farther away, they're not the same galaxies as we see nearby. We will never look far enough back that we see a galaxy that is even a young Milky Way, because the young Milky Way is, well, we're in the Milky Way. You can't go and step out at an earlier time. And so what that means is we have to think very differently about how to compare data of different data sets. So let me just jump ahead a little bit. What do we have to do? We have to then think how we compare ensembles. And when I say ensembles, that's gonna maybe trigger a few words for you. So what kind of words? Well, for one thing, if you have a collection of objects, you can find out their average properties. And then we should be thinking then about how the average properties of things evolve over time. Not how individual things evolve over time, but how the averages of things evolve over time. So we shouldn't take those equations that describe how all the matter moves in the universe. We shouldn't look at those equations and try to work out what individual blobs of matter do as observational astronomers. We should look at what those equations do for specific kinds of objects, and in particular for the averages of objects. Okay, so here are those ugly equations that I wrote down earlier that we can't even solve. So you look at them and you say, I don't know what that means. You know, each equation tells you something about the physics. One of them tells you about how density changes. Another one tells you how the velocities of pieces of matter change. The other one tells you how strong gravity is. They're not solvable by us, okay? There's a particular way these fluid equations are described. It's called Eulerian. It's a fancy word. It's named after Euler. Okay, so now what we want to do though is think about how objects move and objects change. And what do I mean by an object? Maybe a galaxy or a region of galaxies, or where you basically just have a high density region of matter. These equations look a little simpler, or they have fewer terms, and they're called Lagrangian fluid equations. They look like they might be a little easier to solve, but guess what? They're also not solvable, okay? So they may look easier to work with, but they're, again, something we can't solve. But again, I want to go back to this. We're not interested in individual.
I'm going to chime in here just briefly and say, Dan, to folks like you and I, these might look easier, but to our audience, they're just like, oh my God.
Yeah. I mean, this isn't the end. I mean, when people were able to write these down for the first time, they said they look easier, but they're still not solvable. So what's the point of them? I mean, I'm going to throw them away. I'm actually not interested in how an individual object changes, because guess what? As astronomers, we can't measure how individual objects change. I can't look at a galaxy and say, come back a billion years later and figure out what happened to it, or what it's, you know, what it did in the past. There's just no way to do that. So in that sense, these equations, even though someone might say they're complicated and someone might say, well, they're a little easier to look at, they're still nonsense for me, okay? So what we need to do, I'm gonna play some tricks now. I don't wanna spend a lot of time going a lot of math, because then we're going to be down to zero viewers really soon. But, you know, what we want to do is start with a simple, when I say simple, simple for someone who looks at complicated equations. But, you know, you want to take an equation like this, and the math tricks, I'm just going to flash kind of step by step, but not dwell too long. Okay. Some of you who've seen calculus might say, oh, I kind of know what that looks like, but most of you don't need to care too much. We're just playing a trick where we're going to take an average of this and figure out what is the average rate that things change. So we're doing what's called an integral over the whole volume of the universe. That's how you average things. It's like if you wanted to average an average weight for all the people in the earth, you would just sum up all of the weights of everybody and divide by how many people there were, and then you would say that's the average weight. That's basically what we're doing in something like this. And so then it turns out there's a 200-year-old math theorem. This is where I get excited. Okay, I gotta stop for a moment. There's a 200-year-old math theorem called the divergence theorem, which says that if you can sum over an entire volume of everything, there are certain things that just become zero. And so we're gonna lose all the really inconvenient parts of these impossible to solve equations. All the complexity is about to disappear. And so then we're gonna start looking at how these things change over time, and watch. Turns out just substituting the gravity part here. And then you're just left with stuff that you don't even have to solve. Okay, so these equations may just look like a lot of nonsense because they got numbers like 3/2 and a Greek letter omega, which is a number that we already know. So this is the fun part. I've got a 3/2 and I've got an omega, which is a number the cosmic microwave background tells us is, and other data tell us, is about 0.3. So that's just a number. And the Hubble constant, well, we kind of know that to a few percent already. So that's just a number. And this A naught is just basically related to when galaxies started forming, which is we know that number more or less pretty well. And so like every number that would be in here, every letter that's here, any variable, like we know these numbers. All of a sudden we have like a short, sweet, simple answer for how densities change in the universe. That's pretty amazing to me that we were able to do this. There's a term that goes as the square of the time. So when galaxies started forming about 400 million years into the expansion of the universe, galaxies start forming. And then from then on, it's just the clock. What is the time since then squared? Tells you how dense regions are getting. It's pretty cool. And then there's another dependence. This is the really interesting thing too, is we're able to exactly say that if you had regions at early times that were, say, twice as overdense as another region, then this equation tells you they should grow 4 times faster. That's what we mean by the square. So the square is the number times itself. So if you had regions of the universe, if you added up all the regions of the universe that were 3 times as overdense as another set of regions, then they would grow on average a factor of 9 faster. Okay, this is a really interesting set of predictions. I mean, we just derived this. It's really neat. No one had done it before. And while this is very exciting, if I were a theorist, if I were just someone who played with math, I could write a paper about this and say, someone should go out and prove this. Because it's a dead simple equation, right? And it tells us how dense regions in the universe that we find at different epochs should be comparable to each other, because we're comparing averages of ensembles of densities. All right, if I were a theorist, we would have published this paper. In fact, they could have done this 30 years ago or 40 years ago, but they didn't, because it didn't occur to anyone to play these tricks. And so we're left at this stage wondering, what did we do that might be right? Is it right? Can we check it? Because after all, I'm not a theorist. I don't know how to do, I'm not very good at math. It may look so far tonight like I'm like an expert at math, but really I'm, this math that I just did, many people learned in college. This isn't like super advanced stuff, but it's still like any theorist in astronomy would know more math than me. But it just happened to be that I worked it out and I have a lot of data on hand. I have a huge survey of distant galaxies, faint galaxies. Louis connected to this survey. A number of us at Carnegie, we were able to devote a lot of telescope nights because we have our own telescopes. We were able to collect a lot of very interesting kinds of data to multiplex, what does that word mean? It means we're able to collect data on thousands of galaxies at a time to build up a very big database. So this is a big image, it's like 3 degrees across. I superimposed a picture of the moon because this is one image with many colors. We got from the ultraviolet to through the red at the Cerro Tololo Blanco 4-meter telescope using the big dark energy camera. And I put a little picture on the moon there so you can see how big the fields on the sky are that we're actually collecting galaxies over. So we got spectra and data and measurements of distances and masses for galaxies all across this image, like half the galaxies across this image. It's really cool. So we had to get massive amounts of what we call spectroscopy, and Dr. Abramson will tell you a little bit about that in a moment. We had an innovative prism. There's a picture in the upper right here, if you can see it. Some of you have looked through prisms before that disperse the light into a rainbow. This is a very weird looking prism. It's almost like a cube of glass. It weighs almost 50 pounds, but it's 8 little sort of triangular prismatic prisms for making those little rainbows. It turns out that in combination with each other, it makes very short little dispersed rainbows. So in the lower right, you can sort of see they get spread out a little bit and allows us to just collect little spectrograms for, again, a couple of thousand objects at a time. And I think Dr. Abramson will show a few of those in a bit. Of course, when we get there, I think he'll have to tell me when to skip ahead slides. So, you know, we had to map regions on the sky, design big metal plates that would let the light through from specific galaxies because we were targeting them in the infrared. We had to collect a lot of new images, process those data ourselves. It was a big undertaking and it took us many, many years to collect the data and to process the data. Infrared imaging, again, we got from both the Blanco and the Mayol. That's up in Arizona at Kitt Peak. Let's see what we should do. I think we're coming up on Dr. Abramson's part. Yes. Louis, do you want to take over at this point?
Sure. You have control of the slides advancing?
Yeah, sure. Why not? If you want to tell me to do that.
Okay. What time are we? How much time do we have enough?
We have as much time as you like because we don't have park rangers closing the building on us in the park. Normally when we're in our theater, around this time of night, we start to panic and think we got to get people out of the theater. But take all the time you like. This is really wonderful and I'm just tearing up.
Positive externality of our present circumstances. Okay, so yeah, I'm like whatever Dan says about his mathematical abilities, cut those down by a factor of 10 and you have my mathematical abilities. So I am incapable of thinking about the universe, even in the what Dan calls rudimentary math, but which was math that I haven't done in 20 years. And so I have to think about it in terms of actual galaxies and objects. And where I come from, as Dan has been alluding to a lot, is that our goal here, you know, like we call ourselves astrophysicists, but because our data is so different from physics, I mean, you know, in physics you can shoot a particle through an accelerator and make a video of it passing through your detectors and follow its trajectory and all this stuff. And all of that takes place over time. All of the, you know, a ball flying through the air, an airplane moving through the air, someone, again, shooting particles at each other, all of the experiments that you did in physics class, time is a critical dimension. And if you didn't have time, if you didn't have a watch and you could drop a ball and time how long it took to hit the ground, you wouldn't be able to measure gravity. Astronomers don't have time. We don't have any of that because we only get to see these, as Dan was saying, these different galaxies at different distances. And it's true that the galaxies that are really far away, we're seeing them a lot longer ago. But because they're not the same galaxies as the galaxies closer to us, we just really don't have almost any of the access to normal physical intuition that like you got in your classes. So we have to come up with clever ways to try to disentangle the time dimension from all of these really snapshot data sets that we get. And my contribution to this work was trying to figure out, I suppose, if anything, you know, how to tie Dan's math work into a kind of a story that's tellable through pictures of galaxies in different colors. So I'll walk you through how we learned some of that now, And if none of this makes sense, then I'm sure my email address is attached to whatever presentation this is. You can write to me. So, okay. So as Dan mentioned at the beginning, we live in a galaxy called the Milky Way, but as he also mentioned, there are obviously many, many millions of galaxies, many billions of galaxies that are not in the Milky Way. This is a picture of one of them. And surely many of you know that a galaxy is comprised of things, a lot of things, stars in particular. So stars are the things that are giving off most of the light in this picture. This is one star, that's another, there's another in this galaxy. And it turns out that, press forward, Dan. Yeah, stars come in different colors. And this is pretty much critical. If really there's one thing that I want you to take away from this, so Dan's gonna want you to take away why there is structure in the universe. What I want you to take away from this is that without color, we wouldn't be able to know if Dan was crazy. But because we have color, we know that Dan isn't crazy. And in fact, Dan's probably right. So stars have different colors. And this is where good old-fashioned physics comes in. It turns out that different colors of stars correspond to both different brightnesses, in that blue stars tend to be brighter than red stars, but more importantly, for what we were talking about now, different ages. So stars that are really, really big, they burn really, really blue because they're really, really hot. In astronomy, color goes the opposite way as in art. Blue colors are hot for us because they have high energy photons. Ultraviolet light burns your skin. It's got a lot of energy. So violet, blue are hot colors in astronomy. So stars that are glowing blue are big, so they're hot, so they die really quickly. They don't live long. They're young stars. So blue stars live maybe 1 to 10 million years. Stars like our sun live 1,000 times longer. They live maybe 5 to 10 billion years, and they're yellowish, as you know. And then there are yet more stars that live forever. None of these have ever died, and they're red. And what Dan is showing you here, Dan, if you could go back 2 slides, if you look at this plot here, it shows you this connection. What I'm plotting here is the amount of light given out at different colors. On the left is blue, on the right is red. And for big hot stars that don't live very long, you can see they put out most of their light to the left of the plot. And as Dan goes through to suns and red and even older stars, they put out more and more of their light to the red. So we have this connection, this intimate connection between color and the age of a star, which means that when we sum them up, then you can get some notion about galaxies. So as we said, galaxies have many stars in them. Imagine a galaxy comprised of 3 stars, a blue star, a sun-like star, a young star, a middle-aged star like the sun, and a very, very old star. If you add them together, what you get is this white line, the sum of all of their light. And that's what Dan was just showing. The instrument that Dan showed with that prism, it measures that white line. It measures that white line for thousands and thousands and thousands of galaxies, which means it gives you a very, very high precision measurement of the amount of light each galaxy puts out at different colors. And that tells us something very, very important about its stellar populations. So let's stop here. Why the hell do you care about stellar populations? Dan's been talking about averaging things. What are you going to average on? What is the thing? What if I want? Dan said something about, Dan, what was, you used weight, right? Dan was like, I want to figure out what's the average weight of people on planet Earth. Well, how are you going to measure a weight? You got to put someone on a scale. What would we like to average? What is the average quantities that Dan would like to track? Well, certainly we would like to track, you know, what Dan was talking about in terms of an ensemble. How do we construct an ensemble? Maybe we just need to draw a box around things. But, you know, in statistics, one of the things you're probably aware of is something like sampling bias, something where you're counting only certain kinds of objects. And if you don't correct for the fact that the kinds of objects you're counting may not represent the underlying population, you're going to get your answers wrong. Like if you only survey members of one political party in a survey and you're trying to predict an election, it's not necessarily going to be right when the underlying population has people of more than one political party in it. So Dan has to make sure, we all have to make sure that when we look into space and we try to define an ensemble of galaxies, the thing that Dan's trying to describe by simplifying those equations, that we have a representative group of not just, you know, space, but also things like mass and things like maybe even age. And that requires using this spectral information to ensure. So now that was a little bit of an aside. So now what we're going to show, so what Dan did is we go to the telescope, we get all this spectra. The spectra tell you all this stuff about colors. And colors are related to the ages of stars, but also, as we saw, their size. You may not remember that I said that blue stars are very bright compared to red stars. And that means that blue stars have actually more mass compared to red stars at the same brightness. And so if you want to weigh a galaxy, you need color information. So Dan's data from the telescope tells you something not just about it tells you something about the mass of the galaxy too. And that's really what we mean by representative samples, is we want a representative sample as a function of mass. We want to make sure we're capturing all galaxies, not based on their brightness, but based on a more physically interesting quantity, which is how many stars they have in them. Okay, so how do we measure that kind of a thing? The spectrum that Dan showed on the thing gives you the white line, and you can see that if you mix the amount of old and young stars, the white line's gonna change. So you can see it goes from being, you can just see how the white line changes as we add different populations of different kinds of stars. It goes from being dominated by the old population, equally dominated, yada, 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 all this stuff. So if you have the white line and you have some sophisticated modeling, you can kind of back out how representative your galaxy sample is in terms of the ages of its stellar populations. And also, it turns out you need it because, you can go ahead, Dan.
Okay.
You need it because, you're doing great. Because as galaxies get farther away, you probably have heard of this term called redshift that Dan said. It turns out that you also need a color to measure a distance. I'm not going to go into this, but because the universe is expanding and you all know about the Doppler effect of a siren moving away from you sounds lower in pitch than a siren moving towards you. All the galaxies are like ambulances driving away from us very fast, and the light gets affected the same way as sound. So light that starts out blue gets redshifted as galaxies are moving away from us. And it turns out they're moving away from us proportional to their distance. So you need color to learn distance as well. So color is very important. This is all by way of saying, if you want to do anything with Dan's fancy math, which I don't understand, you need colors. And everybody understands colors. So the job of an astronomer, this is it. This is my job. The job of an astronomer is to turn fancy math into dumb stuff like colors. And you can very easily see. So here's some data from Dan's survey. On the left is one galaxy. On the right is another galaxy. And this sort of black line with the red squares, that is like the white line we were just seeing in those other plots that we were just running through. And you can see, so let's overlay these two together now, that one galaxy has more light coming out to the left, and one galaxy has more light coming out to the right. And this means that one galaxy is filled with younger stars. And indeed, it looks like this blue, you can see it with your eyes. You don't have to be, don't look at the plot. Look at the galaxy. You can see the blue light with your eyes. It's a young galaxy. And this other one down here, number 70, the one with the more light coming out in the red, is this spheroidal thing with no sense of blue light at all. And so we need the colors.
This is where I have to chime in and say the galaxy in the upper left is full of those hot young stars. We are here in Hollywood, after all. So that's the Hollywood of the galaxy.
It's a Hollywood galaxy. Yeah. It's a Hollywood galaxy. The one on the bottom is maybe, I don't know, a Reno galaxy.
The Reno galaxy, that is where I grew up. So yeah. It is appropriate.
So anyway, yes, Hollywood is a pretty cool, I live in Hollywood. I'm very happy to take the credit. So the point that I'm trying to make here is, though, all this fancy math, it does come down to pictures. You just have to apply a little bit of ingenuity. You need to know a little bit of a relationship between, for example, temperature and color, and temperature and age. And then you can back out from basically these pictures all sorts of wonderful things about the galaxy populations. And then you know how to make an average. And then you know what to compare to Dan's model. So yes, this is just re-encapsulating what I'm saying. You take 100,000 galaxies. You want me to stop? Dan, you want to go?
Go on. I'll just show this. Yeah, why not? Go ahead.
You take 100,000 galaxies. you do some fancy stuff with them to say how much of them are 50% blue versus 10% blue, and you know, same thing in the red. And then when you have all of this information, you can define an ensemble. And once you define an ensemble, you can do what Dan wants. And I'll shut up now, and Dan can go back to talking about fancier stuff.
Oh, I don't know. I think you do this really well. In fact, you have more insight onto many of these underlying foundations than I do at this point. But it's certainly true that once you know where everything is and how massive it is, then you can start to make maps. And you know, we do special triangulation type maps, but really I think you could do it almost any way you wanted. They're just, this was a fast way to do it for us. But you know,
just to make sure I understand what's going on and make sure all our viewers understand. So what you did is you went in and looked at all these galaxies, you measure their colors, and then from the colors, you can learn what kind of stars have to make up those populations that are within that galaxy. So you get, we have so many young stars, so many middle-aged, so many old stars. And then that tells you the total mass in the starlight in those galaxies and how those galaxies have grown. And then you average this over time, and then Dan can make maps like this that's telling us about the density growth. Is that what I'm getting from here?
That's right. So let me show you here on the left side, right? So we have a region of space that's about 7 megaparsecs on a side. What is 7 megaparsecs? That's like 21 million light years on a side, right? And there's a lot of space between these points. Each of these points is a galaxy that's, you know, has a certain amount of mass. And these are kind of far apart. There's a lot of open space here. So this is a region which is not very dense. But what we can do is we can, you know, kind of draw a box or a funny irregular polygon and add up the masses of these galaxies. And then say, oh, well, we know in this space how much area there is and how much mass there is. And well, we all know how to make a density from an amount of mass divided by whatever volume we're looking at, which is just area times the depth. But if you look in the middle, you know, these galaxies are closer together here. So the density is going to be higher here. And even on this side, where there are lots of galaxies, you can see there's this sort of general pattern where there are lots of galaxies very close together, because the scale in all these boxes is the same. It's still 21 million light years on a side. And so when you look at this, you see all these galaxies very close together. This is probably a very tight group, maybe like the local group, but when the universe was younger, you know, something on that scale. And so it gets very exciting when you can start to do this, because you can then, for a whole region of the sky, or many regions of the sky, as much as you've observed, is look at what the distribution of densities is. And so I'm going to make a stupid plot here, which is a cumulative distribution function. Three people might remember what that is from school. So what I want to say is this along this axis is how, what fraction of the sample, what fraction of the densities we've measured is less than, you know, the number that's along this axis. Okay. So what I want to basically jump to is up here, right here, which is at the high percentiles. You know, some of you who might have had kids, you take your kids in to get weighed and the doctor says your kid's at the 75th percentile. That means that your kid weighs more than 75% of the other kids of that age group. But here I want to look at like the 98th or 99th percentile, regions of the universe at early times at 99th percentile on average were this density, but at later times, many billions of years later, they have an even higher density. So they grew in density. They got more dense. Boy, that's getting to be a muddle.
So really what I'm taking from this is that if you start with a high density, your density is going to grow even faster than somebody that has a medium density, and the medium density grows faster than somebody at a low. In other words, those lines are getting more spread out as you get to the higher percentiles.
Exactly. That's exactly what you can see here, which is very exciting because our math predicted something like that. And so what we want to do is take these curves, take these data, and try to work out, did this amount per unit time work out to be the same as what we derived in our math? What about this amount? What about this amount? And as you see by your eye, Dr. Reitzel, there's less growth in density here, much more growth in density here. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this part, but this is an interesting side here. These are the underdense regions. And they actually have densities that go down with time. I didn't talk about that earlier in the math, but that's what we expect if gravity is pulling material from under dense regions and moving that mass to where the densities are higher, because where mass is, where over densities are, the gravity is stronger. And so in all, it should just, all of this should give us a very simple picture that hopefully agrees with the math we derived. Okay, so what I wanna do is say, we can look at specific points along the curves I just made. So for example, at different percentiles, you can see the density. Oh, that was a terrible way to draw that. The density goes up with time. So this is early in the universe, early, and this is later in the universe, here, later. And the highest density stuff seems to grow much faster than the densities that are here. That's a very slow growth. And we can measure what those rates are. And in fact, from these data points, we get this, let's see if I can change color to blue. You see these sort of contours here that look like this on this side. I don't know if you can see that. But basically the data points give us these inferences for the rates of growth. And what the math actually told us is this diagonal line, like right through the data. See, to me, that was extremely exciting. This has the exact slope.
It's a big deal. It's a big freaking deal. That's a big deal.
Yeah, no, this is. For the folks out there that don't quite see what's going on here, what this is saying is that the equations, the theoretical work that was done is matching the actual observation and analysis. So this is a big deal. This is the payoff part right here.
This is the payoff part. So what I want to do, though, I want to back off for a second because we spent a lot of time on math. I'm showing very mathy things in this plot. So what I want to do is say that for decades, astronomers, theoretical astrophysicists have been running computer simulations that really do a really cool job of making movies of what structure looks like in the universe at different epochs. But not once did any of them tell us, regions early in the universe that were three times over dense than other regions are gonna grow nine times faster. Nobody ever could say that. This is why what we've done, I think, to me, has meaning, because we've now abstracted all of that sophistication, all of that complexity that you could watch in a movie but not fully understand. And we can now tell a story. And we can say regions early in the universe that were a factor of two, more over dense, will grow a factor of four faster than the other regions. And if you happen to be in a very rare region that's a factor of five more overdense than another set of regions, you'll grow in density a factor of 25 faster. Like, we can tell a story now, but now I'm understanding what happens and how galaxies in those regions are gonna get fueled that much more quickly, and why galaxies in those regions will actually probably exhaust that fuel much more quickly. We can actually start to tell, we can explain things better now. Whereas before, you'd look at a simulation, as excellent as they are for reproducing the things that the designers of those experiments wanted to look at, as someone who studies galaxies, I wanted to know what the galaxy economy is, or what the climate is. I mean, the difference here is if you asked somebody to learn about forests, and maybe the physicists would say, well, I'm gonna do a computer simulation of a forest. And they would then say to themselves, well, I need to make a computer model of a tree. And then I need to put a whole bunch of those together. But really, I just wanna know what the forest is doing. And maybe if I just know what an average tree does, because the rates of growth are gonna fluctuate from year to year, but there's some average that follows some other principles or laws, maybe that's all I need, but I can tell a story about the forest and not be lost in the details of what the trees are doing. Now, that's a bad analogy. Well, I like that analogy sometimes. Yeah. Now, there's a curve in the middle of this page here, which I'm just gonna show as this cumulative distribution. But that's basically, if we look at it in a way that many people are used to, it just looked like a bell curve of the initial density distribution. And that's actually very exciting, because the initial densities that we pull out from our data basically look like exactly what we would have expected from the early universe after the cosmic microwave background. Now, the other thing we can do with these data points here is we can actually look and see the, if the time growth here of these points not just goes as the density squared, but we want to know, we can fit all of these curves and ask if they go as time squared. Okay, so our prediction in the math was that the density should grow as the square of the time. And that's time, you know, that's, remember the square of a number is just the number times itself. So it could have been a different exponent, it could have gone at a different rate according to our data, but it didn't. Our data exactly followed the curves that we derived. I mean, this is, again, this is a big deal to all of us because now we have a story, we can write things down, we can actually explain these in a way where we don't even need the big computer simulations to understand stuff anymore. So I guess that gets me to sort of a bit of the summary here. The equations that were laid down a few decades ago that won the Nobel Prize last year, right? They're irreducibly complex. They give us the full picture that you see in computer simulations. You know, they've been the bedrock of all theoretical astrophysics for decades now. They're still of value. I'm not trying to make those go away, but they do, from my point of view, obscure the stories that we're trying to extract from our data. So what we've done is we've cheated in some ways, right? We took these intractable equations and we played some tricks to basically get the equations to say what our data should be doing. How do we match up the expected physics with what is happening in our data? So all of the difficulties of the equations just fall away because of the simple tricks that we were able to perform. And then out pops these stories that exactly match our data. And of course, it took a lot of data. So while we could have made these predictions decades ago, someone could have, the data really couldn't be gathered until probably the last 10 years. But we did take about 10 years to collect the data and analyze all of that data. And it was a tremendous amount of work. It took a team. I didn't list everybody's name. There were 6 or 7 other people, other senior staff members, a couple of other postdoctoral researchers. Dr. Shannon Patel was integral in the, you know, formation of this particular survey and this kind of work. But it's been, you know, incredibly rewarding to be at a place where we could take the time, you know, to really work through what it is our whole field has been trying to do. And so I think, you know, when Dr. Abramson came to Carnegie, he was able to really sit down with me, we were able to come up with a new path forward. So in many ways, it's pretty exciting to have done this and to really, you know, try to lay a groundwork for a new way of doing astronomy. So I've got, I think there's a movie here that can show, and what will happen in principle is we'll start with the microwave background, you know, this picture of it, it's solid blue, but over time, according to sort of early structure formation theory, the amplitudes of the peaks will grow with time. And at about a redshift of 10, what happens is galaxies will start to form. And here's the density field growing in early galaxy formation. And at some point, very soon, here we go, you get the observed things where we're gonna get slices through the data at different redshifts here. And of course, the field narrows here because our data only take a finite extent in angle on the sky. And so, you know, we might be looking at a field that's 3 degrees across, but the farther away one looks, that's sort of a bigger metric scale at those distances. So that's sort of the picture of how structure grew in the universe. And again, we already are able to tell the story about how structure grows on average as time squared and at rates proportional to the initial densities to the power of 2 as well. It's actually pretty amazing that we were able to distill what giant computer simulations that follow the detailed laws of physics, we were able to distill down out of all of that, this incredible story of how gravity feeds and grows the structures that we observe in the galaxy distributions. And those stories have remained opaque, at least for a few decades, but we've opened it up now. So I think that's really the remarkable story here, is that we were able to do some of that math and have the data to confirm it. And of course, I have to thank you for letting us talk so long about this.
Oh, absolutely. Well, thank you. Thank you for joining us. Give you a little round of applause there. Yay! I know we don't have an audience for you. I have a question right off the bat. And if anybody out in the audience on YouTube has a question, you can go ahead and type it in. We'll get to them here in a second. Have you had a chance to go in and analyze any of the large simulations like the Alestris survey or any of the others? Does their density grow at the rate you predicted? Were there guesses?
So this is very exciting. This is very exciting. So not many computer simulations have the volume. So this is really an interesting problem. There are a few simulations.
Why don't you share your screen as well, Dan, so we can
see.
Seeing you this whole time. I know you had some internet problems in your iPad. Thank you for hanging with us, folks.
Zoom and go back to Zoom.
Yeah, thanks for being patient with us there. I know you couldn't see Dan that whole time, but the way... Anyway,
you don't need to see my
Like beard. You said, we've been having internet troubles all along and with all the other stuff. Yeah, thank you for bearing with us. But Dan, so did anybody go into these surveys and have they been doing things right? What do you think?
So this is a really interesting question. So, you know, our data set probes a volume that's almost as big as the Sloan Digital Sky Survey volume. And it takes a volume that big to really do this. But not many computer simulations are both big enough and have the resolution. And so let me talk about what that means, or Louis can talk about what that means. But in effect, computer simulations are run on big, massive supercomputers that have a finite amount of memory and processing power. I mean, they're not infinite in size. And so you may only be able to run a few billion particles for a certain number of billions of years of simulated universe lifetime. And so then you have to ask yourself, if I'm going to do a volume that's many cubic gigaparsecs in size, then each particle that is in my simulation is too massive to probe the kinds of scales that you need to actually do this math. So there's at least one simulation that sort of manages to be in a sweet spot, and it's this multi-dark simulation out of Denmark, I think, MDPL2, if you really want to look it up. And it's really, it was really interesting. So they have some mock galaxy catalogs that they produced for that simulation. So I was able to download those while we were writing this paper. You know, it's in the back of your mind thinking, I need to be checking this somewhere because someone's in a computer run those laws of physics. So they better agree. And sure enough, when I analyzed the fake galaxy catalogs out of that simulation, it was beautiful. It's like right on top of it. And obviously that's incredibly rewarding, but there are some interesting differences. So I suppose I could give you a little inside baseball on that. Like, you have to do this with a mock galaxy catalog. So what does that mean? You can't just look at where the dark matter particles are. You gotta turn that simulation into something that would look like here's a galaxy and has starlight. So there are aspects of the simulation that are just wrong. So if you do the analysis with the starlight of those fake galaxies, it doesn't quite come out right. But if you add up the baryonic mass or add up the dark matter mass, it does come out right.
Okay. So they're not getting their star formation right.
Correct.
Yeah.
That's right.
A little and I don't want to write that paper aspect. Yet.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Now, Alestris is too small. And that's a really, I've been wanting to go with, I think it's still just too small a volume. And it's a problem.
I can see that. Why don't the rest of our Allspace Considered panelists come back here, Laura and Patrick and Tony, if you guys have any questions, take a look here in our, it doesn't look like anyone in our YouTube stream has typed in any questions. Most of our audience can't.
We do actually have a question from the YouTube stream.
Oh, do we? I missed one. Okay, so what is
that? I don't know if it's a really easy question to answer or a really hard question to answer.
Louis, you take it.
Why you're using time squared when you are looking at the kind of the evolution of these galaxies, why are you squaring the time rather than just looking at time normally?
Well, we're not looking at time squared. We're looking at, if you really want to be technical, we're actually only looking at distance. It's just a distance and time are related because of the age of the universe. So what we're doing is galaxies exist at different distances. It turns out that because of the universe expanding, those distances happen to correspond to certain slices at certain times. And you can take slices through you can just collect all of the galaxies at a certain distance, and they represent the picture of the universe at that corresponding time. And what you do is you just measure the densities there. So you just go and you count the galaxies, you draw boxes around them, you say 5 galaxies per light year. That's not the right scaling, but you know, 5 galaxies per light year here, 10 galaxies per light year later. And then you know the time between those two, and it turns out that they're connected by that difference in time squared. So it's not that we're looking at time squared, it's that when you track, when you go to different times and you measure the density in corresponding ensembles, as Dan was saying, the densities in those ensembles happen to change at a rate that is proportional to the difference in time in those two slices squared.
So it's more of a result than something that they chose to do.
Yeah, no, great answer. And perfect. Thank you very much.
And I want to add a little thing to that, because this is something that Dr. Abramson used to also remind me. When you take a basic physics class, either in high school or college, you learn in one of the early parts, when you throw a baseball in the air, follows a trajectory, it goes up, comes down. And when you write the equation for that trajectory, because it's gravity, that goes as time, the height goes as time squared.
That's right, your acceleration.
So this is exactly analogous to that. So your acceleration is constant, it's just gravity, g, 9.8 meters per second squared. But in the end, when you turn that into a velocity and then it turns to a distance, that height goes as just time squared. And so, you know, this in many ways is just the same physics. It's just that we're adding up a lot of baseballs and saying, what does the average baseball do?
Perfect. No, I think that was a great answer. And we'll let you know if we have any more from the chat. But for now, I'll let you guys talk yourselves.
Okay. Thanks, Brandon.
Thank you. And again, thank you, Louis, for help, you know, like clarifying all of the bits that I find very hard to explain.
So I have a quick question for you, and that is, you said this was 10 years and this vast volume of data. What's your next step? Or do you tie this one up and turn to something else altogether different?
You know, which one of us should start answering that? But you know, there's...
I can start. Good. I can start. So, like, I think what's important to understand is that science is not... So science is, strictly astronomy, is very badly misconstrued, I think, in most representations in like the public media. Like what Dan has done, and I think what unifies most great scientists that I know, there are many great scientists at Carnegie. And I think what really makes scientists like good scientists that move the field forward, what their thing is they know how to take a problem that looks really hard and that people have been approaching from one direction incrementally, and then just kind of move the camera around and see that actually from a different direction, it's actually much easier to solve. So it's not actually the smarts. Like, it is much harder. It would take a much better mathematician to solve the equations that Dan showed way, way, way at the beginning than the equations that Dan and I actually ended up solving. But what Dan's moment of creativity was realizing that you don't care about the baseballs. You care about the average of all of the baseballs. I don't care about your individual cells in your body. I care about you as a human and what makes you do things. And I'm going to just forsake describing the cells. Everybody's been trying to describe you from the cells up. I'm going to forsake it. I'm just going to not worry about the cells. And when you do that, it makes certain things much easier. It makes the growth of structure much easier to understand. The question is now, so the natural progression would be, okay, let's take the next level of refinement. What are the galaxies in the volumes doing? So you've described how the density, you've described how the number of galaxies per box evolves. What does that actually do to the galaxies? What corresponds, you know, how does that fact influence the growth of the galaxies, which is what we actually see? And that is the question that we came up earlier when David was saying the simulations get the star formation wrong. Well, the simulations get the star formation wrong because they have asked that question. They've said, okay, we know how gravity is working. What assumptions can we layer on top of that, that when we run through a computer enough times produces things that look like real gravity, real galaxies? So to me, the next step is we have to abandon that. We have to take another approach, another step like Dan did here, which is to don't, the next step is, we have to ask, where is the next step coming from? It's not, what do we do next? Like, obviously there are galaxies. We haven't explained galaxies. But to me, the next step actually has nothing to do with galaxies, and has nothing to do with data, and has nothing to do with even necessarily astronomy. It has to be, we have to think as a group, what are the right kinds of questions to ask of this data set that we have? The data set is different objects at different times. We don't care about the different objects. We care about how an object evolves. That's what the physics feels. How do we take this data and somehow look at it with the proper glasses so that some aspect of that question that we care about becomes answerable? So the next step to me has actually is all about thinking hard about how we actually look at these data, as opposed to what is left in the data that we have that we could explain. I'm sure that question wasn't very, very intelligible to most people. Like, I don't think we're going to figure out why some galaxies are blue and some galaxies are red. We have to figure out a way to ask that question that is easier to solve than the way that everybody else has been asking it to date. And that's just going to take time and some, maybe some beer. I don't know.
That always helps. I was thinking earlier when you guys were talking, and especially around that conversation about, oh, so they got the star formation wrong, how much it felt like being at a bar at a conference with a beer or two and this kind of conversation, except now, you know, after a beer or two, then ramp it up. And, as you know, to the point where people are at, you know, on the verge of shouting, then that's kind of, you know, now you get the feel of a scientific conference.
That's right. I think you're right. I mean, and Louis brings up a really interesting part of it, which is really thinking about what those right questions are. And, you know, for decades now, there's just been that layering of assumptions about how stars form, put them in those assumptions into simulations. And maybe what we need to better understand is, what would it take to know or learn that we got any of that right? What, you know, what is it in the data? What is the information that's present? And I think, you know, he and I are fortunate to be at Carnegie at the moment because, you know, the pressure is on to simply think about that. The pressure is not on to write, you know, more incremental papers, which are important in their own right for many other reasons, but for them, you know, where we are, we can take time and think about, you know, what do the data mean? What is the information that's present? But really, what are the questions that we're trying to answer? And so, you know, you asked the right question for us. It's like, what's the next story we want to try to uncover? And I think it's not obvious to us. It's just not obvious yet.
I think you have some interesting populations to compare. If you take an object that's at, oh, half a time earlier, but at a density that is double, it should be the same as a, you know, you can compare things at different ages and different densities, and the populations within those should look similar, because you have similar growth in those times. Now, of course, you're going to be in different parts of the universe, but still, there's something interesting in there to pull out. I don't quite know what, but.
I think you're right. I mean, there's no question that what you need to be able to do to compare any sets of galaxies, pardon me now, is you then have to look at these densities as ways to locate the full fair ensembles that you can compare from one object to the next. Mm-hmm. I would say we have a complication in doing that with the data we have, because ideally, what is it you need are measurements of the matter density that are not connected to your starlight measurements. Because, right, we've measured masses using the starlight, and then if we're turning around and saying, ah, but, you know, in this region where we have a lot of starlight, we have galaxies that are, say, you know, on average bluer, which also generate more starlight, you know, can become a little too circular. And so there are some surveys ongoing that are using a technique called tomography to actually look at, right, the sort of lower density baryons as a tracer of the dark matter density. And I think as those tomography surveys really come online, there's one being done at Carnegie right now in a small field, but when the prime focus survey gets done at Subaru, that may provide a large enough field with enough tomographic density and measurements to then start to say, ah, okay, we have overdensities here. What are the galaxies like there? And then you can start to then dovetail that to this map.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping we laid some of the foundations for that kind of, approach. and time will tell. You don't really know yet.
Now, final question here from me. Are you planning to do some pointings? Now, I want to say it's the Roman telescope. Are you planning on doing any pointings with that? Because how many would cover your field? It looks like 6 pointings maybe or something like that.
Well, I think, you know, the GTO survey data will already presumably be, you know, the guaranteed time observations, they're already going to have these massive legacy data sets that I think people should 100% dive right into doing this sort of analysis. They may find where my stuff breaks down. So then the question just becomes, do I want to do that? Or maybe I should let Dr. Abramson do that because, it's his job to show where I'm wrong.
Exactly.
And that is the strength of science. And it kind of goes to what you were saying. And I guess I was calling you Louis earlier. So Dr. Abrams.
I'll call him Louis too. It's both. It's but, he's younger than me. So
about the nature of science, because that's the whole point. Isn't necessarily to, it would be great. But even if you have aspects of your conclusions that need to be modified by what's learned next.
That's right.
It's the next, level in the scaffolding, and that's how it all works. So that's a good thing. Absolutely.
Yeah, it is a great thing. It's a good thing.
It looks like Tony has a question.
Yeah, I know we didn't do a story tonight on some galaxy that was discovered that looks like it's far more evolved, I think, than somebody was expecting it to be at its great distance. Oh, yeah. So I'm just curious, does your work suggest that we have a lot to learn about what to expect at great, just after the Big Bang? Is what you're doing applicable to what our expectations might be, what we'll find with James Webb, for instance, looking?
Louis, do you want to start with that one, or do you want me to write? I'm happy to start. I think one of the things we saw here, I'll just inject a little technical bit, right? So the densities grow as the time squared. What does that mean? That means there is something called a stochastic process, that is matter growth. And I know it's going to sound a little technical, but it means that the rates at which matter is accreted onto nascent galaxies is of a particular form where the growth of galaxies just occurs very rapidly. So when star formation begins in earnest, when the universe is a few hundred million years old. Now, maybe James Webb will show that it started when the universe was 250 million years old or 325 million years old, and that will be important information to know. But what this math shows is that the growth of stellar mass, the growth of stars and galaxies, occurs so rapidly that really almost right away you will see more massive galaxies than people have thought about before, and even more evolved looking ones than people have thought about before. Natural consequence. Yeah, go ahead, Louis.
No, I was just to turn that into lay speak. It's not surprising. None of this galaxy, the existence of this thing is neither surprising nor, I'm not even sure it was unexpected under the old paradigm, but it is, we should find, it's rare. But, there's as the universe is big. So we should expect to see many more of these objects from James Webb. And in fact, we should expect to see them as a function of density. Like they should tend to live in environments with slightly more galaxies than other things because of what Dan showed. Environments grow fat, more anything, where there's more stuff happens. So you should expect to see these things slightly biased, we call it, towards high density regions, but you'll find them in low density regions too, just less of them. So we haven't gone through the rigmarole of predicting how many of these things James Webb will find, but this, the existence of this thing is not terribly surprising to me.
The natural consequence of having so much grow so quickly is that the stuff that stars make comes out more quickly and sooner, perhaps, than many people would have just had a gut instinct for. So there's a lot more dust production. There are heavy elements that get produced right away through the supernova in those systems. And right away, you see galaxies almost as massive as the Milky Way, you know, in really just a few hundred million years. It's then suddenly like, wow, you know.
And yeah. I want a prediction of how many POP3 stars there are.
And how many direct collapsed black holes?
More than zero.
Yeah.
More than zero.
Yeah, I don't think I've worked at that scale yet.
Yeah, not quite. So. Well, this has been super, super interesting.
Thank you, Dave.
I just want to make a quick comment from the chat because I've had the opportunity finally to take a look in the chat. And Dan, there's a comment that how lovely it is to watch you talking about the cosmos and see the sky, the night sky behind you. Maybe have not looking at the set decoration you have there, but it's very nice.
And it's a little overcast and hazy. You missed the full moon rise earlier, though. It was lovely.
Yeah, and we've missed a lot. We've had some clouds at night.
Nice.
Louis, you said you're in Hollywood, so I'm imagining you're kind of down in the thick of the lights and the lights, cameras, attention.
I have to sleep do I have it here? I'm in my bedroom. I have to sleep with a mask on because there's so much light pollution. But yes, no, I'm by the lights and the cameras and the action. We have the Walk of Fame is in my little jurisdiction here. So we're right in the thick of it, but you know.
Yeah.
I like it.
So before we say goodnight, Brendan, are there any questions? I didn't get all of the questions on here. So if you have any.
Not any big ones that I saw. We answered a few, the moderators answered a few as the night went on for just kind of the basic stuff, but I think we covered most of the big ones.
So since it's very late and this has been a very intense and dense couple of hours, but so much appreciated by all of us and all of our audience who, you know, which we have still have a pretty significant audience hanging in all these hours later, which is nice and speaks to people's passion for the kinds of things that you guys are doing. So we really say thank you for coming. I also want to say a thank you to our audience who it looked great as usual. And it's always so much more fun when we're in the room together. I wish we were in the same room and that day will come. It will. We just have to, take the long view, which I guess is something astronomers do readily anyway. At least last comment of mine, and if anyone else has any, but is to say that we don't have an All Space Considered next month because we'll be celebrating our Independence Day, which is I think technically the next day, but the city holiday. And I think I've explained this before. We're not permitted to work on city holidays because we're city employees. We won't have one. But we do have a wonderful Mars mission launching. Keep your eyes open on that. It's kind of unbelievable that in all of this craziness, so much is still happening. I mean, launching the first people. I mean, how did they even do that? And while the rest of us were, you know, sticking at home with our masks and stuff, they're out there making history. And that's true with the Mars team too, working from their homes. So same thing in the Goddard team. I failed to ask Ken about that when he was with us, but we talked about it earlier, just what the scene is there. And, so it's really inspiring to know that in the face of all of these very, very challenging times that, you know, some of these really long lasting, immutable, important enterprises of humanity are still at play and still important and that people still care about them. And there's, you know, something that we can all celebrate together. So I guess if anyone has any final comments, I just want to say, thank you to everybody and be strong, be safe, be compassionate, support each other because everybody's struggling. Anything else from anybody else? All right. Well, good night, everyone. Thank you again.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Now I have to figure out how to turn this thing off. We didn't go over that. I guess I could just close something.
It's gone.